Greetings, I'm Bairnt, and welcome to Meet Me at the Table. Today, we're going to be playing through the Isofarian Guard. We're going to begin our epic narrative, bag-building, story-driven extravaganza. That is the Isofarian Guard. This is an immense, epic game, and I'm excited to dig into it. Before we start, I do want to mention that I will be using the Forteller app for the narrative section of the Isofarian Guard. After all, they are going to be way better at it than just me just reading from the book. If you're interested in learning more about Forteller, I'll put a link in the description of this video. Isofarian Guard is only the tip of the iceberg when it comes to what Forteller has to offer. They have a lot of games that they have done the narration to. On top of that, they also have a Fabler portion of their company that gives great music and ambient sounds and sound effects to any role-playing game experience that is you are interested in using. So please check out Forteller. They are going to have a link in the description of this video. Also, if you like what you see during the Isofarian Guard playthrough, don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit that bell so you know when more content comes out. Also, if you're interested in supporting the channel, a link to my Patreon is also found in the description of the video. Now, if you're excited to see the Isofarian Guard, then I need you to meet me at the table. Before we begin starting the playthrough of Isofarian Guard, I do want to mention that I will be putting timestamps in the video. So if you don't want the story of this game spoiled, you can go ahead and skip to the parts that are not the narration of this. If you see this symbol up here, those are the things that are narrated by Forteller, and that's pretty much the entire narrative of this game. Now, without further ado, let's check out the prologue by Yuri.
A cold wind bites into your face as you stare across the killing field. It makes your eyes water and then freeze, covering your eyelashes in tiny ice crystals. You close your eyes to melt the ice, and so you won't have to stare at the bodies. The Falmundians lay piled up in the narrow pass where you and your fellow guards had ambushed them. A few soldiers had managed to survive the initial arrow barrage and attempted to flee, but they only provided slightly harder target practice. Even with your eyes closed, the images are etched on your eyelids. The surprise on the soldiers' faces, followed quickly by fear and panic. They hadn't stood a chance. Already, the wind and snow are working to sweep the carnage under a fresh white blanket. You and a couple of the younger guards begin picking through the dead like carrion crows, searching for anything of value. You brush the snow from a fallen captain, revealing a face that is far too young. Reaching into the dead man's pockets, you are rewarded with a folded piece of parchment bearing the broken wax seal of Falmund. Inside is a hastily scribbled letter in a script you can't read, most likely marching orders for the deceased squad. It feels odd to be holding the letter that sent its bearer to his doom. If the soldiers had been able to carry out their orders, it would be you lying in the snow alongside your brothers and sisters. You suddenly feel very tired. What is it all for? The senseless fighting, the waste of life. There is no meaning in it. With a sigh, you rise from the corpse and begin making your way toward Captain Grigory with the letter. On the way, you pass Pavel and Yana, who are busy rifling through another corpse. They glance up and notice the letter, nodding in approval, before returning to their grim task. Captain Grigory is deep in conversation with Vera, Catherine, and Karzin when you approach with the letter. The captain notices you and breaks away from the group.
What have you found, Yuri?
A letter on their captain, sir. Probably orders, but I can't make it out.
Captain Grigory scans the letter and frowns.
This is odd. It appears this group was not part of the regular army. They were a special detachment calling themselves Stone Hunters. What could their purpose have been?
I have heard of these stone hunters,
says Catherine, stepping forward.
They have bought into their Mad King's delusions about the Stonebound.
Stonebound? You mean the rumors of people with magic powers?
Yes. The Stonebound supposedly use special stones to give them magic powers. This group of stone hunters must have been tracking some poor soul when they made the mistake of crossing into our lands.
Oh, it's all nonsense,
interjects Vera.
The Stonebound don't even exist. What kind of fool believes in magic and fairy tales?
What do you think, Carson? Do you have any insight on the matter?
Carson looks down at his boots and inhales slowly before letting it out. He seems to be weighing his thoughts. A few moments pass before he seems to reach some decision. He looks up slowly and meets the captain's eyes.
It's not nonsense. I have seen a Stonebound with my own eyes.
Carson waits to be interrupted, but everyone is silent, waiting for him to go on.
This was a few months ago. I was on a galley patrolling just off the east coast near neutral waters. We had been out for about a week, and we were just making one last run of the coastline before returning home, when five Fallman ships came out of nowhere. They had been hiding in a cove, waiting for us. Before we could react, they had lobbed a ball of burning pitch right at us. Captain, I knew in that moment I was going to die. I could only stare as that ball of fiery death got closer. It was a perfect shot. And then it was gone. I couldn't believe my eyes. We all looked around to see what had happened. Someone pointed up at the cliffs above us. There was a lone girl standing there. I didn't get a clear look at her before she...
What? What did you see?
Well, sir, she jumped.
She jumped?
Yes, sir. My heart leapt into my throat. I thought she was going to die, but she didn't. She flew towards the fallen ships like a falling meteor. Halfway down, a brilliant spear appeared in her hand, and she drove it right through the deck of the lead ship.
Vera begins to laugh. It starts as a snicker and builds up to a full-on belly laugh.
Why have we never heard of this meteor girl of yours, Carson? Let me guess. She destroyed all the ships, then flew back into space, but not before stopping to give you a peck on the cheek.
Enough, Vera.
It's true. She destroyed every ship there, then disappeared.
Vera doubles over in laughter until nothing but wheezing comes out of her.
Oh, Carson.
Carson turns away in disgust.
I know what I saw.
I don't doubt your sincerity, my friend,
says Captain Grigory, placing his arm around Carson's shoulders.
But perhaps you were so scared in the moment that you weren't thinking straight.
Captain.
It's okay, Carson. We'll speak more of this later. We need to check on Pavel and Yana, then head back to Silny.
Captain Grigory heads back down into the narrow pass, followed by Catherine and Vera, who is still chuckling and wiping tears from her eyes. You put your hand on Carson's shoulder, offering silent support before following the others. When you reach them, your breath catches. There before you stands Pavel and Yana, each holding a strange stone. Stranger still, they are glowing. Carson smiles and looks at Vera. She isn't laughing anymore.
And with that event, we are in Chapter 1. The campaign book brings us an overview of how to set up Grigory and get the campaign underway. Chapter 1 is going to serve right here as a tutorial, so there's not going to be too much deviation from this, but once you get through, I believe, the first chapter, you're going to see that this game opens up and gives you the ability to explore not only the area around you, but also all those different narrative events that are going to happen. So you don't have to just keep going through the narrative events. You can run around the countryside, and I guess you could say the world is technically your oyster, if as long as you can survive in this death of the dangerous world of Isofarian. So we'll start by getting all of the basic stats set up here: health, attack, defense, and action points, and all the equipment and weapons and armor we're going to need as well. We'll then begin building Grigory's bag, and it does say that you're going to start with 3 attack and 2 defense. You're going to take 3 attack chips and 2 defense chips and place them in his bag. I believe this is the only place where the actual stats matter as to what chips you get, because as you go forward, you're going to go through some skill trees where you'll be able to put chips in there, and at that point, you may have more chips than you actually have values, and you'll kind of see how that works as we play through the game. Also, each of our different Isofarian guards are going to be gaining cards that they're going to be using. It's going to be their abilities, and they're going to have to spend action points and chips in order to make these different cards activate. And you'll see again how that works. It's a really cool system of starting with this primary side, and they're going to flip back and forth, giving more abilities and hopefully combos to not only themselves, but also their other companion that they have. Then on top of that, we're going to get a stone-bound ability called Cross Slash. And I'll explain that card when I show it to you. At this point, I think it's just best to show you the board and show you everything I'm talking about. So we'll start with our 20 health right up here. The max Isofarian Guard can have, from how I understand, is 30, but you're going to have to use different types of cubes to get to that point and be able to show how much you're actually taking. We're going to start with 3 attack and 2 defense. It did tell us to take 3 sword chips and 2 defense chips, and we're going to place them into our bag. And if those of you that did not get a chance to see my unboxing video, these bags are really cool. They are a deep set bag, so you can really get a lot of chips in here, and it's not too tough to dig in there and grab them. There's a lot of room in there, which is absolutely awesome. We do have 2 different counters up here that we're going to be using as we play through it, Sill and Lux. I'm showing you them now. I'm debating if I'm going to be switching these out, because technically mine just kind of spin to the wind, and I would hate to figure out that one of the numbers got bumped and I didn't catch it. So we might switch that concept out as we go forward. We have our starting abilities down here. We have our Captain's Blade, our Guard Tunic, and our Health Potion, and these are all 1-star. As you go forward, you're going to gain more equipment and different armor and weapons, and they can go up in stars, meaning they're better overall than what you are. Now, this tunic is for everybody. It shows down here that it is an unlimited symbol, and it can hold 1 of those stones, but we only have 1, and that's going to be for our Cross Slash, and I'll explain how that works in a second. Again, we also have our Captain's Blade, and this shows you how much extra damage you could potentially do as you're going through, and this shows you the chip, what you're going to use in order to activate his basic attack and how much it's going to do. So if you used one of the chips on here, it would do your basic attack. For us, that would be our 3 damage. And on the back again, it shows that this is only for Grigory, and it can also hold 1, it has 1 slot for a stone. We do have our health potion that we can use during battle. Now, we can only use anything that's in our items section during the battle when it's in this slot. If we have other things in our satchel area during the battle, we can't use those. You can only use the items that are actually available to you in this area of the board. Same with accessories as well. So you kind of want to make sure you have everything you want before you go potentially into a battle. Or if you ever go into a narrative event, you again cannot change out anything unless, of course, something in the narrative event allows you to do it. So make sure you're prepared before you go in there. During the exploration phase, you can switch out things as much as you want from your satchel to here. But once you get into combat or you're in the narrative event, what you have is technically what you are going to be able to use, like I said, unless something changes. Here are the 3 abilities that he starts with: Guard, Feint, and Advance. Notice they have the P symbol up there. That is their primary side. Now, in order to activate these, we are going to have to draw out potential chips. Let's say we drew these chips out of here. These, of course, you can only draw a certain amount of chips equal to your action AP total. So you can't just draw every chip out of here. But let's say these are some of the chips we had. So we could use 1 of our action points and spend it on this chip. And when we do, we're gonna be able to gain this ability down here. When active, I get +1 defense and I get to add a defense chip to Gregory's bag. Now the defense chips are not gonna be these. We're gonna be doing the green ones up here. I have all my chips right up here. These green chips are a little bit different because after the turn they go, once you draw them and use them, they're gonna go back up here to the supply. Anything that's purple would actually go to our exhausted area, but the green ones go back in there. Now, the interesting thing is when you go to the cleanup step, which you'll see how this goes during the game, you would actually flip this card after removing the chip. And notice it has changed and it has a new ability. So that's one of the cool things about this is being able to use your abilities, the best of your ability, best of your ability to use your abilities, that's a pretty awesome sentence, and flip them back and forth to give you the best advantage in combat. The last thing we have is our cross slash. This is our runebound card, our garnet. This is our garnet that we were supposed to get. So we're gonna be able to put this into our weapon. And when you do that, you're gonna take the garnet card from the box and place it under your weapon. Now the cool thing about this card is on the back, it shows us that we get to add, yet again, another chip to our bag. So we're gonna add a black double sword to our bag, making our bag start to grow with chips and power. And of course, those double swords can activate something really cool. And at any time, you can always use two of something to equal a different thing. For example, I could make two shields equal a sword, or I could make two swords equal a shield. And this would count as two swords equaling a shield if I wanted to, for example, activate that guard ability we were just talking about. Now we're gonna take this and put it under our weapon. If we ever decide to change out our weapon, our garnet isn't gonna be on it anymore. And when we decide to use this ability, we'll be moving this stone around to show that it's either that we're activating it, that it's in cooldown, or that it's ready to use again. And again, you'll see how that works during the playthrough. Now at this point, we are going to put our bust chip on node 28 and proceed to page 4 to begin chapter 1. We have found node 28 on our giant map, and instead of using the bust, we are going to use our awesome miniature that I had a chance to paint up. And if you're interested in seeing how these are painted up, I do live paintings on my channel. I try to do them about once a week, and we paint up some of the awesome games from that we're going to be playing. So we were planning to play this one, so I got it all painted up and ready to go. And if you're interested in telling me what you're interested in seeing painted, or have any interest in how the games develop and go on throughout, you can join my Patreon. The link to that is in the description of the video as well. So please check that out if you're interested in supporting the channel and giving a chance to be able to take control of the games that we play. All right, we have putting him down on number 28. Let's begin chapter 1. This is going to be the Mountain Pass. And of course, this will be told by Grigory. Forteller, take it away!
Pavel and Yana are glowing. You blink your eyes, but nothing changes. They just stand there, glowing.
Stonebound.
The word forms in your mind. You immediately begin scrambling for other explanations. A trick of the light, a hallucination. Anything to explain how two people can be standing right in front of you, glowing.
Captain?
Yana's quiet voice pulls you out of your thoughts. You look up to see she is staring at you.
What?
Your voice catches. You can't seem to remember how to speak.
Captain? It's okay. Everything will be okay.
She smiles and places a small stone in your hand. Time ceases to exist. You are surrounded by an immense presence that threatens to overwhelm your senses. Pieces of your life flash before your eyes. Your father teaching you how to string a bow. Fishing for striped fish through a hole in the lake ice. Laying in the loft as mother's stories fill your head with wonder each night. You also see darker things. Stealing a chicken from Brother Fenn's yard. Bloodying Carl's nose in a childhood fight. The terror of your first battle. The face of the first soldier you ever killed. Just a boy whimpering for his life as you struck again and again, trying to silence him. You look up and see a vast darkness stretching out before you.
Tenors.
It rolls over you like a fog, burying you in shame and regret. Suddenly, a voice calls out to you from beyond the chaos. You turn to the voice, and the darkness is shattered. You breathe in, out, and everything is okay. When you finally open your eyes, your guards are all around you. Pavel, Yana, Catherine, Yuri, Vera, Karzin. You look at each of them and see that you are all something more now.
Stonebound.
The word comes to you again. In the back of your mind, the voice is still there, speaking to you, guiding you. You sense that it is calling you to a valley, the Valley of Lux.
Guards!
Your voice is odd in your own ears.
I know not what is happening, but I know that nothing will be the same again.
Your words seem to break some strange spell, and time resumes.
I can see that you all have experienced something like what I have. While we have been fighting our petty wars, a great darkness has come upon us unseen.
Your guards are silent, no doubt reliving their own experience with the enveloping shadow.
But fear not, for there is a mighty presence who guides us now.
At this, your fellow Stonebound look up hopefully, and there are even a few smiles.
We can all hear the voice calling us to the valley, and I wish to go. But I feel it is my duty as captain to warn the king of what is coming.
You continue before there can be any objection.
Karzin, you are the most experienced guard here. I want you to lead everyone to the valley, while I travel to Silni. If I can make the king see the truth, we can strike a mighty blow against the shadow.
Karzin looks at you intently.
Captain, I will do my best, but I can't help thinking you're making a mistake by trying to convince the king.
Perhaps, but I owe it to the people of Isofar to try. They must know that the Stonebound are real. When I'm done, I will meet you all in the valley.
You give one last look to your guards, your fellow Stonebound, before stepping on the road to Silni.
We'll place narrative chip on node 32, and that'll be the way we advance our story. If you don't want to advance the story and you want to go do some other things, you totally can, but once you want to get back to the story, that is the node you're going to want to go to. We're going to move Grigory's chip to node 30 and follow the instructions for the exploration phase, which you're going to be able to find on page 18 in the rulebook for more on the exploration phase and what to do when you move the guards to a yellow node. If a skull is drawn, we're going to go to a battle, which you can learn about on page 22 to 27 in the reference guide for a round of battle example. Follow the instructions for the exploration phase again. Once completed, move Grigory's chip to node 31 and follow the instructions for the exploration phase again. And once completed, move Grigory's chip to node 32 and place the Silini mini-map on the table and place Grigory's chip on Silene's Seer's Gate. Then proceed to page 6 and read chapter 1.2. We'll place our narrative chip right here on 32 like it says. And now that I think about it, we're all by ourselves, so we should probably be removing this guy from the miniature. So he's all by himself just like that. And yes, they do remove from the miniature, which is cool. You know, I could, if I wanted to, just use this instead if I wanted to make it just a 2D type thing. But I like having these little miniatures out here. I think they're absolutely awesome. There are multiple of these narratives in the chip area. So if there, you may at one point have more than just one of these as you're playing the game. Now, our goal is to get to this narrative chip here, so we're going to move our character one space during the exploration phase. Now, again, I could have gone other places if I wanted to. There is a couple exceptions here. This red one, you cannot enter unless it has to do with what you're working on right now. The orange ones you see here and also here, those are entrances into particular areas that have mini-maps that, like it said, we're going to be bringing this mini-map for this city out once we reach that particular area. But the yellow ones are a primary type of node that you're going to find on the minimap, and it's going to make you draw from the event bag. And there are two different types of chips you can draw from that bag, either a skull chip or a compass chip. So let's move to 30 and see what we get. We'll take our black bag that we have, and we'll add in a 1 skull, 2 skull, 3 skull, and then 2 of these compass chips into this bag. Give it a good old truffle shake here, and we're gonna draw out a chip and see what we have found. We have found ourselves a compass for number 30. A compass can denote a field event that could potentially be gained. The way this works is if there are less than 3 purple cubes on the field event deck, immediately place a purple cube on it, and then you have 3 options. So we'll place just our purple cube next to one of these decks, and each one of these decks has to do with a specific region. We have the mountain region, the plain region, and the forest region. The mountain region are going to be the ones numbered 1 to 20, which is up here, and you can always find that right here on the side of the cards. You can see the numbers of those cards. The plains deck is the yellow numbers. They're located here. And we have the final one, which is the forest region. And these are all going to be node specific. Our specific node is 28. So we fall within the plains region, which are nodes 24 to 77. 1 to 23 are the mountain ones, and they're going to be the upper part of the map. And 78 to 108 is going to be the forest region. There are a few other miscellaneous ones that are going to hit certain categories of these, but those are generally the larger numbers, or the larger amount of which ones these will be part of. Since there are not 3 there, we are going to be done with placing the cube, and then we have to decide. We have 3 options. We can either choose to continue exploring without having any type of battle, or we can choose 1 battle from the events from the enemy index for that particular node. The other option we could do is, if we did have 3 purple cubes here, we could choose to do that field event. Here's the enemy index for chapter 1 on nodes 28 through 58. Since we are on 30, we can either fight a level 1 star brigand marauder, and he is going to be put in row 1. We could fight a timber wolf, also at level 1, but it's in red, so do know that red means that you are going to be ambushed or surprised. They're going to get a free turn against you, and on top of that, you cannot flee if you are ambushed. And the other one is, we could fight a mountain bear, and do note that these do have up, their difficulties does go up as these skulls grow in, I guess, rank here. That would be how I would assume it works. So since this is a playthrough and we want to do some fun things, I think we should take on a brigand marauder just to see what it is and how this game all unfolds. The first thing we're going to do when setting up an enemy is we're going to grab his battle board here, and their card here is our brigand marauder with the 1 star. It also shows his stats down here. We'll place him right there and put his stats out here. He has 7 health according to this number here. He has 1 attack, 1 defense, and he gets 2 action cubes. Before we go too much further, I do want to mention that that compass that we did draw does go back in the bag, and you could draw it again at a later date. With only 1 attack and 1 defense, again, might not be too tough. We'll see though. We're then going to take the Brigand's 8 card deck. You're going to know if you have all the cards by this little number down here. So they are 1 through 8. You're going to give this a good old truffle shuffle so it's all set to go, and we'll place it down in the Brigand's area here. This is where we're going to draw his deck, the enemy AI deck, to see what he does to us, and when we'll discard him as we go. We have an extra action point here. I just put some extra cubes out here in case we need them in future battles. Here's a player aid to show the start of a round. We always start with the guard unless we're ambushed or there's something else during the narrative that tells us otherwise. The first thing we're going to do is check equipped accessories for bonuses, and we're going to trigger any effects that they have. We don't have any of those at this time, but there could be one that, for example, at the start of combat, you get 1 sword token chip. Put it in your bag or something. And the other one now is going to be discard any active evasion chips, any blue cubes on both guards. Green evasion chips are returned to the supply, while purple evasion chips are just moved to the guard's discard area. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to choose a guard to activate, and this does make a difference because sometimes the enemy will target the person that has attacked recently. In other words, somebody that has gained an aggro token, and you'll see how that works. The next thing we're going to do is, if the guard's bag is empty, we'll refill it with chips from the discarded area. If the bag is not empty, but we still want to do that, we're going to have to use one hit point to refill that bag. You are allowed to look into this bag at any time you want to see before you draw chips for your turn to see if you wish to actually do that. And of course, we don't need to because our chips are all in here. We're totally full up and ready to go. At this point, we will draw chips one at a time from the guard bag equal to the activation points, either the green or gray cubes that we have, and resolve any positive or negative chips as each is drawn. Only black chips count against drawn chips. So for example, going forward, say we do get some of these green or purple chips into our bag, they will not count toward the amount of chips that we can draw equal to our action points. They're kind of like getting bonus chips, and we all love bonuses. Once we draw all of our chips out of the bag that we're going to be able to use, we are then going to act. We're going to take actions in any order, or you can use it. Some of these or none of these, it's up to you. We can activate those guard ability cards by paying the necessary cost. We can activate our stonebound ability card and use the speaking stone gems. We can perform a standard attack on a single enemy target by paying the chip cost. You can only do this once per turn. You can't use multiple chips to activate just a standard attack, unless, of course, again, something is giving you the ability to do that. Then we can activate any accessories by paying those costs as well. And then we can use any equipped items. Now remember, the only item we have right now is our potion. So we could use this during this time to heal ourselves 5 health if we ever thought we were getting too low. At this point, then we'll activate the other guard, repeating steps 4 through 6. We'll refresh any action points, and then here's where we place the aggro chip on the guard that last attacked. So if you have somebody that's low on health, you may not want them to go second because they're going to have the aggro chip. Now, the aggro chip doesn't necessarily mean you're going to be attacked, but it kind of breaks ties when there is one. So let's reach into Grigory's bag here and draw out chips one at a time until we have 2. We got our double sword, and let's draw another one. We also have a sword. We got 3 swords. Wow, that's really good. We can only draw out 2 because we only have 2 action cubes. Now with the chips I have a couple of things I could do. One, I could play this as a basic attack down on my sword card, which means I would be doing my damage, which would be 3. I could do 3 damage to our enemy with this chip. Or we could activate this advance with this chip. And the other thing we can do is, remember, we can use any 2 symbols to equal a defense symbol or 2 defense to equal a sword symbol. I could use this chip and my action token here to give myself +1 defense. That means that now I have 3 defense for this turn. And then I get to add a green defense chip to, whoops, that's not a green defense chip. Here's my green defense chip to the bag. And that's the one thing I could do with that chip. Then if I wanted to, I could use this chip over here on advance using my last action point. And I could gain a green sword to my chip bag. And on top of that, if we look here, it says chain, add another green to the chip. Now, how did I know I chained? That's a great question. Anytime for Grigory, every Isofarian Guard is a little bit different. He's got these neat chain abilities that go on. So that when you play and take advantage of a guard card for Grigory, any other guard card you take advantage of after the first one that is activated is chaining. So you're going to be able to use the chain attack on the bottom or whatever it is on the bottom. So I think we're going to do that. So I'm going to grab these 3 chips and place them into our bag. I know I didn't do any damage this turn, but maybe I'm setting myself up for a big turn in the future. So we'll drop those right in there. We'll place these 2 into our exhausted area, which is located right here. And in order to get those back, remember, I either have to take a hit point and damage and stick them back in my bag, or if I have nothing left, I'll be able to refill it that way. The action point costs actually go down here. I don't place them on the cards. I was just doing that to show you exactly how they worked. I then am able to, if I wish to, and I could have done this before I did that if I wanted to, because you can do these in any order, I could activate my stonebound ability, and you totally know I'm going to. I don't see why I wouldn't activate my stonebound ability, because this is going to attack all enemies. Now, there is only 1 enemy, but if there were multiples, it would hit every one of them for my attack value +1. So that is 4 damage. So we'll look at our Brigand Marauder here. He's going to take 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. He would go down to 3, but he does have 1 defense, so he is going to stop there. He's only going to take 3. 1, 2, 3, just like that. I'm going to choose not to use my item. There's no reason to. We're going to get our action points back, and I'm going to give myself the aggro token. Now, he's only playing by himself. We don't have anybody else with us. Remember, Isofarian Guard is normally a 2-player game, or you can play solo, but you do have to control the 2 Isofarian Guards. And as you can see, there's not a lot going on, so being able to control 2 is very manageable in this game. At this point, it is now going to be the enemy's turn, so he's going to discard any green evasion chips or blue chips that the enemy has. We don't have any of those. Then we're going to activate the enemy in slot 1. At this point, we will draw an AI card, and from the enemy's face-down AI deck and place it in the face-up discard pile. We'll resolve any actions on the card, and we'll activate remaining enemies in order 2, 3, and 4. We'll repeat steps 3 or 4 for each enemy, then we'll refresh the exhausted action point for the enemy and move into the cleanup phase. Now our vile marauder does have 2 action points that he's able to do. So we're going to draw our top card, place it over here, and we are going to resolve this card. Now normally go there, but I like to hold it up to the camera so everybody can see what exactly is going on here. We'll choose our target with the highest attack value. Now of course, if both of our characters had the same attack value, it would go to whoever has the aggro token. We're going to attack the target. He's a dirty fighter, so he's going to use one of his action cubes, so he's going to move it over to there, to do +1 attack and add 2 of these particular tokens to the target's bag. So now it's going to be an attack of 1+1, so it's going to be a total of 2. Looking down here, he has 1 attack, and adding 1 means he's going to do 2 damage. Doing 2 damage isn't going to do anything because we have 2 defense, and we have +1 right now, remember, because our guard is up. Sadly, we are going to gain some red weakness tokens. We're going to gain 2 of these according to the card, 2 to the target's bag. This is going to give our attack -1 until the end of the round. So we're going to place them into the round bag. So not only do we give some good chips in there, we also get horrible bad chips from the enemy. Now, sadly, that was only the first action point. He still has 1 more, so let's continue going. It now says choose target self. If you have less than 7, it's going to bandage. So it's going to use its final action points to bandage itself and heal 3. And at this point, we will now end our turn. So he's going to heal 3. 1, 2, 3. Went back up there. We didn't even do any damage to him. The final stage of the combat is our cleanup phase. We're going to discard all the chips from enemies and return them to the supply except for green evasion chips. We don't have to worry about that. There aren't any. Then we're going to discard all chips from the guard ability cards and weapons and flip the cards over to indicate they flip after being active. Black and purple chips are moved to the guard's discard area and green chips are returned to the supply. At this point, we'll then discard all chips from positive and negative chip area on the guard's ability dashboard. Purple chips again are moved to the discard and green and red are returned to the supply. We'll then move exhausted speaker stones to the ready slots, then activate speaking stone gems on cards to exhausted slots. On our board, the only things we're going to be doing is moving these down to the exhausted. I know I moved them once, but that was just to show you where it is. Now we're actually going to do it. So we're going to move that one, but then we get to flip this card because we used it. So now we're on take cover. It's going to cost us 2 shields and an action point, but it's going to be able to gain 2 defense. So now instead of 2, we'd have 4. If we're able to chain it, we're able to get a green action cube, meaning action cube that we're going to be able to use for the battle, but we'll be removing it at the end. We're then also going to be able to flip over our advance. Our advance is also going to flip over to critical strike. If we can get 2 swords on this, it's going to take both of our actions, but the enemy is going to take whatever our damage is +2. And if we can chain this, we can draw 2 chips from Gregory's bag as well. That would be awesome. We'll put those there. Now we do have to take our gem and put it in its cooldown position, so we can't use it moving into the next round. At this point, we'll begin again and choose a new guard to activate. All the things we do before that are not going to take place in this battle. So we're going to mix up our chips again, hopefully not draw those red ones. Those are terrible. We drew ourselves a black sword. That's one of our actions. And let's see what else we got. We got a green sword. Now remember, that does not count towards our action total, so we still have more we can draw. Let's draw some more. Come on, we need another sword. Let's see what we found. Oh, we got a shield, and it's a black shield, so that is it. We have drawn our 2 black tokens or chips, so that's gonna be the end of our drawing phase. Let's see how we want to use these. I think what we're gonna do is we're gonna start by using our sword and shield right here and one action point. And this is going to give our opponent a -1 defense chip, meaning their defense is now down by one, and that's fantastic. Because the next thing we're gonna do is just activate our ability to attack and do 3 damage. And with the -1, it is gonna be 1, 2, 3 damage down to 4. We are done, so we'll refresh our action cubes, and we'll now draw a card for our enemy and see what we have found. We have found Brigand Marauder. Choose a target, lowest defense, or aggro, so that's gonna be him. He's gonna hit with Sword Thrust. It's gonna cost one of his action cubes to do +2 damage, so you can do a total of 3 damage to us. Then it says here, if attack deals no damage, draw a card. It did deal a damage, so we are gonna end turn. That's gonna be the end of the Brigand Marauder's turn. Because I took 3 damage, 2 plus the one he starts with, meaning I took 3, I only have 2 defense, so I am gonna go down to 19. At this point, we'll refresh the AP, go into our cleanup phase. We're gonna remove all chips from the enemy's dashboard, and we'll clean up our dashboard as well. We'll move these 2 black chips to right there. We're gonna flip over our faint card, and now it has preparation. I can add one of these to Gregory's bag, which is gonna give me additional attack, and I can chain to add another one as well if I'm able to. Now I do need that sword shield, and I need 2 shields and 2 swords to activate any of these. The green chip that we have is gonna go back to our supply, which is not gonna go into this area. I do get to refresh my rune-bound ability so we can use it next turn. Moving into Grigory's turn, he doesn't really have anything except to draw his chips. Let's see what we get. We'll mix those chips up in the bag and we'll grab this one. We have a green shield, that's good. We have there's that pesky red one. I knew those were eventually gonna come out here. We have a black sword and we still have some more chips in here. We got another red one, yuck. Whenever I'm attacking, it's gonna do -2. We got another green one. We got all of our chips except for I have to deal with the 2 red ones. Oh, what horrible timing. So here's what we're gonna do. And I'm not exactly sure if this is exactly how it's supposed to go, but we're gonna give it a shot. First off, I'm gonna use my 2, actually, I wonder if I do this, I can get an extra action next turn. That'd be pretty good. Oh my gosh, there's so much to do. There's so many different ways of being able to puzzle this out, which is kind of cool. But I think what we're gonna do, which is probably going to be, I think this is gonna be better. We're gonna use the 2 swords over here on the attack to do +2 damage to the enemy. Now remember, we have the -2 going on, which is super awesome. So it's just gonna be a straight attack of 3 minus his 1 defense. We're gonna do 2 damage. So let's go down 1, 2, 10. He only has 2 left. And funny enough, I was gonna do this to activate the +2 defense and give myself an action cube. But I think what we're gonna do instead is I'm gonna use my cross slash, which is gonna do 4 damage minus the 2 is gonna be 2 damage. And then minus his 1 defense is he's gonna be at 1 health. And then all my happiness just came to an abrupt halt. I was gonna play both of these shields to equal a sword and be able to attack him, but I would only do 3 damage and I would have to subtract 2, meaning I would do 1 damage and he still has 1 defense, so he'd do nothing. So instead I am going to do my take cover maneuver with my other action point, and I am going to gain 2 defense and a green action cube. So I'll place that right here. That's gonna be the end of my turn. I will move those 2 action cubes up and we'll place our negative stats right here, which is where they're supposed to go, not right in the middle of the board. It's supposed to go over here. And these are the ones that are positive stats. And we'll move into the enemy's turn, and unless he heals himself, I think he's gonna be in a world of hurt here. It says here that he is gonna target the next ally, which is technically me. Diversion, it's gonna cost me 1 action point. Ally draws 1 card and performs all actions he doesn't have an ally. Okay, next ally, which he doesn't have. So this is actually gonna do nothing. Ally draws 1 card and performs all actions at 0 cost. Ally cannot draw another card after actions. Now my question is, does he become the next ally? I believe, let's just say he does. So diversion is gonna cost him 1 action. And the ally draws a card and performs all actions at 0 cost. Let's just do that, that'll be fun. So we're gonna do one like that. Now I'm not sure if that's exactly how that card goes, and if it doesn't, please let me know in the comments below how you think that works, or if you know for sure. And please also check the pinned comments of this video for any post-production errors. I'll usually put them in the comment section in a pinned comment at the top. So we're gonna draw another card and activate everything at zero cost just for the fun of it. Safeguard. This is gonna be free. He's gonna gain 2 until the start of the next turn. Then if he has less than 7, he's gonna bandage, which is gonna heal himself by 3, 1, 2, 3, up to 4. He's gonna gain a blue cube, which is gonna add 2 defense to him. So he now has a total of 3 defense, which is absolutely awesome. I don't know why I thought it'd be good to draw another card. Maybe that wasn't a great idea. He's gonna gain back his action cube. And then we'll go into our cleanup phase. We'll move our cube down there. These are gonna be returned to the supply, our 2 green chips. These are gonna be put in the discard pile. And these vile contraptions are gonna also be returned to the supply. Man, if only I would have not had those on the board, this guy would have already been defeated. I do have to flip both of these cards back over. They go back and forth, back and forth. That's how those 2 cards work. So let's get these cards out of here. Sadly, I just cut my fingernails, so I can barely get anything out of these things. And so we have our guard and advance card back. And if I pick up my bank, it's empty, which is kind of good because I don't have to spend any health to get all of my chips back. Now, the only ones in here are my black chips. So I'm only able to draw out 3 chips because we do have this extra action point now. So let's go ahead, shake this up, give it a good old truffle shake here, and draw them out. I kind of want some defense now because I'm not going to be able to do too much to them. I've got a sword, and hopefully we don't get another sword. We got 3 swords. I'm not going to be able to do anything. He's got 3 defense up there. So with our swords, I think what we're going to do is we're just going to activate this preparation ability with everything I have, because it's going to cost me 2 swords to do that, and then I have 1 sword extra. So we're going to use all 3 of these and 2 action cubes to activate that. Oh, I think I might have made a mistake last turn. I think this was 2 action points in order to activate, and I used it, and I used the other one as well. It is 2 action points, so I made a mistake. I wasn't allowed to use both of these cards. What was the other one I had? It was this one, right? And I said I activated this, so I'm not going to be able to do that. I couldn't take cover because I needed the extra action point. So I guess that's okay, because I didn't get a chance to even... Did I gain the action cube? I did get the action cube, which means, okay, we're just going to keep going, but do know that you have to watch how many action points you have available here. So I made a mistake. I wasn't supposed to do that. I only have the 2 action points that it costs to do that because I didn't notice that before. So it's going to cost me both my action points to do this. Sorry about that. I'm going to gain 1 of my plus attack. Is what I'm going to get. I'm going to get a +1 attack. We're going to put that into our bag, which is going to be great. Now, remember, I only really have 1 sword left in there, but that's okay. Well, hopefully we'll grab that and some defense and turn them into swords as well. That's the end of him. We'll refresh our action cubes and move on. Hopefully he doesn't do what he did last time. We'll see what he does. He is going to choose self. Oh, he's going to do the exact same thing. So he's going to gain 3. 1, 2, 3. He's back to full health again. Oh my gosh, I'm getting a little sick of this guy. We'll go to the cleanup phase and move our cards down here, or our chips down here, and flip over our preparation card. Again, sorry about the fact that I forgot how many action points that these cards need to use sometimes. 2. All right, that's the end. I guess we'll move into our phase. We're going to keep the blue cube on him because he gained it back. That was awesome. I should have taken off before his turn, but they just got it right back. So we're going to draw out 3 tokens here until we get 3. Okay, we got a double sword. That's fantastic. We've got the +1 attack. Well, he's got the 3 defense. That'll be really good for us. A shield. And our final chip is our shield chip. So we've got all of our chips again out here on the field. That's all 3 of our actions to get these 3 black token chips. Let's see what we can do with them. I think it's time to get some chains going because I don't have really anything I can do to that guy with his 3 defense up. That defense is out of control. I'm going to spend 1 to activate this, which means I'm going to be able to gain myself a +1 defense. And I get, what is this? I get a green defense chip to the bag. So we're going to put that into the bag. At this point, I can use a sword shield here, and then, oh no, I don't want to do a sword shield. Why not? We can feint. We can add -1 to the, oh, wait a minute, maybe we could do damage to him. Give him -1. No, we're going to save this. I think it's going to be better. I'm just going to use this as a sword, but that's not going to do any damage to him. I got chips I'm not going to be able to use. I think we'll just throw this over here. Gain a green chip to Gregory's bag and another green chip. So I'll have 2 sword chips to my bag. That's fantastic. Now I've kind of wasted some of these chips. I can't really use some of these, especially the +1. That goes away. That's so sad. Didn't even get to use it. That was awesome. Well, what can you do? That's how it goes. And this one I didn't even get to use. I'm just going to put it in the discard pile because there's nothing to use it for. I need a sword on that one. And I can't split this. I can't just say like half of it goes over there and half of it goes over here. You can't do that. You have to choose all or nothing. So that's the end. We're gonna refresh that later. All right, that's the end of him. Man, something else. At least this time I used my two actions. I didn't screw that up. We are gonna refresh the two actions I used back up there. And then I am getting sick of this Mr. Brigand here. Hopefully it doesn't do anything. Lowest aggro. Attack, good. Sword thrust, 1, plus 2 damage. If attack deals no damage, draw a card. Ah, it did something. I'm actually happy I took a damage. We do have to remove this cube. It's no longer there. He has 1 defense. He is going to get smashed. I'm going to hit him with a lot of stuff, I hope, next turn. So I am going to take 1, 2, 3 attack, which means I will take 1 damage. And then we will refresh all of this. We'll flip these cards again if I can get under them because I just cut my fingernails. There we go. Those 2 flip over. Now I have to pay 2 for this one this time. This also gets refreshed, so I do have the ability to use my stonebound card if I want to. There is only like 2 chips in here, so I am going to take 1 damage to throw all the chips in my discard area into my bag, and we'll be able to give these a good old truffle shuffle here, and we'll draw out 3. Come on, I want some good ones. We got a sword. I want lots of swords. Come on, sword, 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 sword. We got another sword. Oh, I love green swords. Green swords are awesome. Green swords are amazing. I love green swords. Oh, a shield. Okay, that's okay. I need another green sword. Oh, a double sword. Okay, we got 4 swords. That should be pretty good. All right, we're going to start by using a shield and a sword. We're going to activate this for 1 action point. We'll slide it right down there, and it's going to give -1 defense to our enemy. Our enemy already has 1 defense, so a -1 is going to bring him to 0 defense, which is going to be fantastic. So we'll place this over here on his board. And then we're going to see what we do next. We're going to probably hit him really hard. I'm going to hit him with a 2 sword attack with my last 2 action cubes over here. And I'll be able to chain that, meaning I'll be able to draw 2 more chips from Grigory's bag here because I'm chaining it from the last attack. So we're going to draw this one, another sword. I like that. And another sword. Now those chips are not going to be, from how I understand it, counted as like action chips. So the green one and the black one are both considered technically just 2 chips that we're drawing from the bag. I could turn these into a defense. I don't want to do that. I'm going to stab him with my sword. So I'm going to hit him with my sword, and that one's just going to kind of hang out. That's going to be the deal. So we'll be attacking for +2 with this critical strike. We're also going to use our stonebound ability. And we're going to activate our natural attack. And I still got another, I got 2 swords left, but I can't really do anything with them because everything I have costs at least, and costs some action points. I don't have any of those left, and that's really all I got. So with 0 defense, from our runebound attack, he's going to take 4 damage. 1, 2, 3, 4. From our regular attack, he's taking 3. 1, 2, 3. And from our critical attack, he's taking a total of 7. I could have told, or not 7, 6. I think 3, 4, 5. He's going to do 5. So he got absolutely murdered in the line, finally. Oh my gosh, this -1 token is awesome. Even without that, he would have had a huge problem coming in at, what was it, 3, 5? So 1, 2, 3, 4. Then he would have gotten hit by the runebound 1, 2, 3. So just those 2 alone could have taken him down. If it wasn't for the fact that he had that double defense up for a couple of those rounds, it could be really quick to take these guys down. Now, once a creature reaches 0, you flip the card over and you reap the rewards. We're able to gain 2 lux and 3 sil from this marauder. So we'll take our dials and put them at 3 sil and 2 lux. And lux is your experience points, and sil is your gold that you're going to be able to use to buy things or help in crafting certain items as the game goes forward. Now, to level up your characters, you're going to need 10 lux, and I'm not sure if during the first chapter it's going to happen. We'll see if we can get it, but there we go. That's the end of our first combat. Let's continue on with the narrative. But before we do, I just want to go through all of the end of battle steps for you so we can get our characters set up for the next one. We'll return all chips on enemy dashboards back to supply. We've done that. We'll collect the rewards from defeated enemy. We did that as well. We'll return the enemy and the enemy AI cards to the index box. I have done that off screen. Then we'll return all black and purple chips on both guard dashboards and ability dashboards back to the guard's bag. So we're going to take all of the black ones that we used, which are going to be these that were left on there. We'll put those back into our bag just like that. Then we're going to return green and red chips on both guard dashboards and ability dashboards back to the supply. So the green sword chips we had out there are going to go back to the supply. At this point, we will return green AP card cubes to the guard dashboard back to the supply. So we'll put that back in the supply. will flip all guard ability cards back to their primary starts and move all speaking stone gems back to their ready position. Now, the one thing that you're going to see on there that is kind of interesting is the fact that, remember that green defense chip we have in here? That stays in our bag. It doesn't go away because that's not how this works. It's only the ones that are on the dashboard are going to be the ones that go back to the supply. So we can use that in an upcoming battle. Having completed our first battle, I guess you could say, we'll continue on down the road. We're going to move to 31, which is just another one of these yellow nodes. So we are going to draw from our bag. And remember, this is the exploration phase. So technically, we didn't have to go this way, but narratively, we're supposed to continue down this because this is kind of a tutorial. But you could move in other directions as well, exploring the map if you wish to. Also, you can see right off here to the sides, there's like mining and foresting things. And down the line, as you play through the game, you're going to want to be gaining these type of resources so that you can use them to craft or potentially build other weapons and armors and things. We're going to mix up our chip bag here and draw one out and see what we get that we're going to have to deal with. We are going to, look at this, a 3-skull chip. Oh, boom. Let's see what that is. Look at this. Our book tells us we are ambushed by a mountain bear. Oh, this is going to be sweetness. We're going to set our mountain bear up and he has ambushed us. So that means we do not get to flee from this battle. He does start with 12 health and he has 2 action points and he has one defense and 3 attacks. So this could be just a battle of who can hit who fastest. Who can do the most damage? So we'll put another cube out there to signify that he has 12 health. He does have his 2 action cubes. And we're going to give our deck for our bear a truffle shuffle here. And we're going to draw the top card. Since he ambushed us, he does get to go first. Let's see what he is going to do. He is going to do a mountain bear attack here. Choose the target with the highest action. Well, of course, that's only one person. So he is going to embrace for 2 action points. And it's going to deal damage +2 and exhaust 1 action cube from the target. Oh no, that's terrible. All right, so he's going to do 5 damage to me and I have to lose one of my action cubes. So we'll slide one of our action cubes down here. We have 2 defense. We took 5, so we're going to take 3. 1, 2, 3. We're almost already at the same level as him, but we do get to go now. This is going to be our turn, so we're going to mix up our bag and see what happens. We grab the right bag. It's one thing you got to make sure you get the right bag's right spot. We have found ourselves the green defense chip, so that's actually fantastic because we are only able to pull 1 cube from here. So we got a sword and a shield. That should be pretty good. We'll see what we can do with those. If we look at all of these cool abilities we have, we could do the guard and then the advance. But the problem is we only have 1 action cube at our disposal because the bear gave us a nice big hug. So I have to choose which one we want to. Of course, the other one I can do is this one. But really, it's only going to give him -1, which I have to believe is going to go away at the end of the turn. So it's not that big a deal. I think we're going to do the shield. I want more of these shields. Plus, I'll get an extra shield for now, and then we're going to use this to just activate our weapon. So for now we have +1 defense. I'm just gonna put a blue cube there, and then I also get to add a shield token to my bag. I get to add a green one, I can't even pronounce the colors, to my bag. I'm going to use my sword. It's going to do 3 damage. He's got 1 defense, so it's going to do 2. On top of that, I will ignite my cross slash, doing 4 damage with 1 defense. That is 3, so we did a total of 5 damage. The bear is going to go down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. He is now at 7 health, and we'll see what we can do next. Now, what I could do is I could use my healing potion for 5 health, but I think we're going to save that. I'm just going to put my action cube back up and see what happens. We'll draw our next card and hope it's not as brutal as that card was. This one says the highest. Oh, no, it's the same card. It's the same card. I got hit for 5 and I have to lose an action cube. Good news, I have 3 defense now, so I'm only going to take 2. At this point, we'll go to the cleanup phase. It's a little different because that enemy activated first. We're going to return this one to our chip pool right up there. This is going to become exhausted. We're going to flip this card and we'll put this chip into our exhausted area. I also should have gained the aggro token. I forgot to do that. I'm going to remove that blue cube and we're going to draw into our bag. I again lose 1 action cube and we get to draw 1 to see what happens. We have drawn a double sword. Wow, a double sword. I don't think there's anything I can even do with that except just I'm just going to hit him. I'm going to hit him for 3. That's about the best I can do. Now, even though there's 2 swords here, you can only ever activate this 1 time, your main attack once. My other option would be to activate our advance. I could do that. Maybe that's a better idea. I could add a sword to my bag. It is going to cost me my 1 action. Let's do that. Let's add a sword chip to our bag. Sometimes it's better to get as many of these into our bag as we can so we can start pulling more tokens. And the good news is this bear can't be doing that hug forever. We'll gain back our action cube, and we'll see what Nature's Fury can do to us this time. It will be our bear's turn. He's going to remove any tokens and things, but we don't have any of that on him. He's going to be doing this instead. We're going to choose the person with the lowest health. Well, that's me. He's going to claw me for +1 damage. If the attack deals damage, draw one card. Oh, no, that is going to deal damage because I only have 2 defense, and he has a total of 4 health. So I'm going to take 2, bringing me down to 10 health, and I have to draw a card. Now, we also have to remember, this does cost him 1 action cube, so I do have to slide one of these cubes over to there. The other reason I haven't been doing it before is because I took both his actions to do that maneuver. Let's see what he's doing this time. He's going to choose the highest action cubes. He's going to do a crushing bite, but it's going to take him 2 action cubes, and he does not have that, so his turn is going to end. We got super lucky on that. That crushing bite was going to do 6 damage. Oh my gosh, it's out of control. He's going to gain back all his cubes at this point, and we're going to go to the cleanup phase, which means we'll put this into the discard area, and we'll now have an active ability called Cross Slash to do. Let's draw some chips and see what happens. Like I said, he could only hug us for so long. I now do have both of my action cubes. Let's see what we draw out of our bag. We draw ourselves a sword, and we drew ourselves a green sword. That is awesome. I'm loving green swords. I want a green shield too. No, I drew a black shield. So those are the 2 chips we drew. Let's see what we can do with them. Now, I did forget to flip this during our cleanup phase, so I'm going to do that at this point. And now we have a couple chips, or 3 chips, I should say, that we can do something with. We'll have to figure out what we can do. Now, of course, we could always attack for 3 damage if we wanted to. But I think what we're going to do is we are going to activate this one right here with both of my action cubes, meaning we're going to attack one enemy for +2 damage. Our damage is normally 3. It is going to be 5, which is awesome. And then we're going to activate our cross slash, which will do another 4. So we're going to do 5 damage and then 4 damage. And sadly, this chip is just going to sit here. There's nothing I can really do with this chip at all. Our main attack will do a total of 5 damage. -1 is 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then our cross slash ability does 4. -1 is 3. 1, 2, 3. Oh, we made it through the bear. I barely made it. Oh, I'm a funny guy. I do have 10 health left, but now that he's at 0, we get to see what rewards we get for killing the bear. We get 4 lux and a bear pelt. We'll put our bear pelt into our satchel, and notice it has a 1 here. If we ever get another bear pelt, instead of gumming up our satchel with a bunch of 1s, we could flip this over to a number 2. It'll go up to 4. That's the highest you can have a single resource in your satchel before you have to put more in a different satchel if you wanted to. But for now, we have 1 bear pelt. We also get 4 lux, so we're going to go up to 6 on this. We had 2 from our last fight. We took down a really tough bear. We're going to clear our enemy board. We're also going to clear our board ourselves. We're going to put these back into our a little baggy thing here. We'll put that into the bag too. Now this one I do have to put back into my chip thing, but remember, just like before, I can look in this whenever I want, and now we still have that green shield again from from our battle that we just had. That's pretty awesome. That's a cool system, how you can kind of, if you're lucky enough, you can kind of keep that bag kind of keep going even from combat to combat. Grigory had a few hard-fought battles, but we're going to move now onto the actual narrative adventure here. We're on 32. We're going to clear that chip, and we're going to check out what happens when we get there. Making it to that narrative moment, it tells us to grab our mini-map for Silny, and we'll place our person right down at the Seer's Gate, which was the node that we came in on. Now, since this is a narrative event, we're going to be doing what it says in the book. But if you were just doing, for example, your exploration phase and you came to this town, you could come into this gate, do things you wanted to, and then leave from another gate and place yourself back out on the map in a different location. So say we wanted to come out this location, we'd be coming out on node 33 up here. So just to tell you, it's kind of neat that you can go into these cities and then out of these cities in different ways. You don't always have to go in and out from the same way you start. But we're going to go to 32, and there's a narrative event that we're going to read from the, listen to from Forteller and see what happens. We'll be doing chapter 1.2, Silny's Seer's Gate, from the point of Grigory.
You round the final bend in the road and see the walls of Silny standing before you, cradling the city beneath the sheer face of Mount Ural. You never cared much for the bustle of city life, preferring the company of a few good soldiers and the peace of the wilderness. still. It has been a long day, and a soft pillow beneath your head would be most welcome. But first, the king.
Who goes there?
The familiar face peering down at you from the wall is wearing a lopsided grin.
You know exactly who it is, Alek. With you guarding the wall, I'm surprised Falmund hasn't already taken the city.
It's good to have you back, Captain. Open the gates!
There is a slight pause before the Seer's gate cracks open, and then swings in with a great groaning of timbers. When you step through the gate, Alek is there to meet you.
Where to, Captain? The barracks or the Raven's Beak?
Neither, I'm afraid. I must speak to the king immediately.
The smile drops from Alec's face.
So you came upon trouble on your patrol, then?
Yes, trouble and something else.
You suddenly feel self-conscious about being stonebound. You determine not to say anything until the king is notified.
I see. Keep your secrets, then. Let's get you to the king.
Moving right along, we're going to move the chip to the castle and proceed to page 7 to read the next chapter, page 1.3. The castle is located right up here, and as you can see, the map is sitting right on top of the other map. Their space for this game is a premium. There are a lot of things that are spread out, and of course, you can take down and put down whatever you want, but for recording purposes, I like to keep everything out. So some of the stuff you see is going to be actually right on top of other materials. I apologize for that, but we're going to be going to the castle Strazh right now. So here we are at the castle.
After passing through the chaotic city streets, you see Castle Strazh rising above the inner walls. Alek escorts you through the inner gate before passing you off to a member of the King's Guard.
Farewell, Captain! If you get the chance, stop by the barracks before you leave the city. I know the guard would love to see you.
Thank you, Alek. I'll be sure to do that when I'm done here. Make sure to keep your eyes sharp on that wall.
You return Alec's salute and turn to ascend the steps to the Great Hall. Two more of the King's Guard pull open the hall doors, and you are greeted by the booming voice of King Karst.
Gregory, my faithful companion, I'm glad to see you. But your early return does not bode well. Tell me, what have you encountered out on your patrol?
King Karst's frankness is often jarring to outsiders. But you know that the king doesn't suffer foolish pomp or idle pleasantries. It is often best to get straight to the point.
My king, we ambushed a band of Falmund soldiers in the mountain passes west of here. Judging by their brazen actions and the material they carried on them, my best guess is that they were stone hunters.
Ah! Stone hunters! King Joram has gone well and truly mad! He now sends good soldiers to their death on a fool's fancy.
My king, I know this sounds unlikely, but King Joram may not be as mad as we suspect. I have seen something that will change our understanding of the world.
You pause, screwing up your courage before uttering,
"The Stonebound are real."
King Karst locks his gaze with you before a new voice breaks the silence.
The Stonebound do not exist.
A cloaked shadow emerges from behind the throne.
Greetings, Temnota. I was wondering if you would be skulking back there.
Such disrespect is unbecoming in one of your stature. I'd be more careful, especially after espousing such heresy.
The truth is not heresy.
Well then, show us the truth.
And this narrative does have branching paths, and this is just the first one of many we are going to be running into. So we're going to have to choose our path. We can either prove to Timnota that you are stonebound, we can proceed to page 9, or you can speak to the King Crest in private. I do not think this guy is going to be any good. I'm just going to show him what I got. We're going to proceed to page 9 and read chapter 1.4. Also, I want to mention that I am just showing the words, but there are some really great artistry that is going on inside of this game. Not only the components, but also the book itself has some great images. And here we are still in the castle with Grigory showing off his power.
You hold your sword aloft, and it emits a faint glow. It seems to gather in the shadows from the room and absorb them into the sword. As the shadows disappear, the sword grows brighter.
Simple tricks for fools,
sneers Timnota, but you can see that she is visibly shaken.
You make a mockery of our way of life and will bring ruin on us all. Sire, you know that King Joram will bring all-out war to us if he even suspects that we have found this power.
King Karst sits stunned on his throne. He stares at you as if seeing you for the first time.
Who are you?
Timnota raises her voice again.
Sire, we cannot afford to go to war over one delusional captain. Captain Grigory has proved his heresy by his own actions. To claim there is a power other than that given to us by Yuvadet is blasphemy worthy of death.
As Timnota speaks, the sunlight streaming in through the windows dims as if a cloud has passed in front of the sun. King Karst stirs slightly, but his eyes also seem clouded over. He finally lifts his gaze and speaks to you.
You must leave these lands.
Sire, this isn't you. Timnota has poisoned your mind.
That's enough from you. Guards, you heard the king. Captain Grigory is hereby banished from Isofar. Take him away!
The king's guard steps in to escort you out of the hall. But just before you leave, King Karst seems to recover slightly.
You may take any provisions you need from Fort Strass.
Timnota's eyes widen slightly before she narrows her gaze to give you a withering stare.
Be safe, Captain Grigory.
Something is afoot. We're going to place our narrative chip on Silny's Rynok Square and move Gregory's chip to the Silny Rynok Square. Then we'll proceed to page 11 and read more of this narrative from chapter 1.6. And here again is a great piece of art found inside the narration book. There's a cool sword that I'm holding up and I'm showing it off to the world, but sadly that didn't go as well as I was hoping. So here we are going to Rynok Square. Hopefully we can find some provisions that I'm going to need because I'm no longer allowed in this city. Oh no, this is gonna be bad. And there is going to be a narration that goes along with this particular node.
You pass through the streets of Silny in a daze. There is no doubt that Timnota and the Circle of Seers have been thoroughly corrupted by Tenebris. Your heart aches for King Karst, but you can only hope he can resist Timnota. Perhaps you can rally support from the guards at Fort Strazh. Maybe there are some there who would listen to their old captain, even if he did claim to be stonebound. Lost in your thoughts, you realize you've wandered into Rynok Square, the bustling center of Silny. The crowd is thick and noisy as merchants call out to potential customers, and people weave around the heavy carts rumbling along their routes between warehouse and stall. Out of the corner of your eye, you happen to catch a glint of steel. You instinctively raise your arm to block the blade, but the attacker scores a small hit on your arm. Timnota certainly didn't waste any time.
So lucky for us, we were able to take 1 point of damage. I wouldn't call that lucky. I am down to 9 health. And now we have to look at this. It says battle event. We're going to place a 2-star Seers assassin. Remember, we've only been fighting 1-star enemies right now. In the AI deck on the enemy dashboard in slot 1 of the battlefield, we're going to begin a battle phase. And if defeated, I can restore his hit points back to 20, remove all the negative chips from my bag, and begin the battle again. Health potions is not recovered if used. So we have to decide if we use this. I'm already half dead. Maybe fighting a bear and a brigand wasn't the best plan on the way in to see the king. We'll see what we can do against a level 2 seer assassin. This guy's gonna be out of control. He has 15 health. All right, 10 plus another one, 15 health there. He has 3 action cubes. And okay, so with 3 action cubes, that's terrible. We do have his little deck here. We're gonna give this a good old truffle shuffle here and place it down on the board. We'll draw chips from our bag. Now remember, I only get to draw 2 chips because only 2 action points. He's got 3. Let's see what we found. We've got ourselves a sword, and come on, we need something else good. Hopefully we can do something really good off the bat. Okay, we got a shield and a sword. They're both black, so those are going to make us stop drawing. I could choose to attack, or I think what I'm going to do is we're going to start activating our cards right away. I'm going to activate them in this order. I'm going to grab a green chip from here, and I think I'm going to grab a sword chip from here. Now, I'm also able to combo one of these depending on which one I want to activate first. I could combo this to grab another shield, or I could grab this to grab another sword. Now the problem is, I think if I remember right, this is a level 2, a 2 in order to activate. I think this is also 2 action points to activate on the other side. I think we're going to grab a sword. I like more swords. I can do more damage in theory. And I'm actually going to hold this for 1 turn. Most of the time I like to just use this, but I think I got a plan. If I can activate this and be able to use this also, we might be able to activate this and attack with this at the same time, being able to chain this if I can make one of these other ones activate as well. So we're going to do that. We're going to grab these and put them into our bag. I know this is a long shot. We'll see what happens here. We're going to stick them right into our bag, and then that's going to be the end of our first turn. But right now I am sitting on 3 defense. Let's see what we can do. Oh, his attack value is 3 and his defense is 2. That's terrible. Let's see what he's going to do to us. He is going to do a seer assassin. Is going to choose the, doesn't matter who he chooses, only me. Disrupting dagger. 1 action cube to with +1 damage to discard 2 sword chips from the target's bag. Oh, barf. And swiftness. Gain another green cube, or gain a green cube. Oh my gosh. All right. So he's going to get an extra action cube. This one's going to cost him 1. It's really not going to matter because it's going to end turn. No matter how many action cubes he still has, it's still going to end the turn. I am going to get attacked for what? 4? And I have to discard 2 chips from my bag that are swords. Good news, I have 3 defense, so I'm going to only take 1 damage because that was only a +1 to hit. These are the 2 sword chips I chose to discard. We're also going to discard these 2. We're going to flip these 2 cards. And we're going to, I should have got my action points back at the end of my turn, but I've just kind of put them on the card so you can see everything that's going on. At this point, I get to draw more chips, and there's a lot of good chips in here. There's a lot of green ones and not many black ones because they actually made me discard a lot of those. So I got a shield. I've got myself my double sword. Let's see what else we can get out of here. We got another shield. Let's keep drawing. We got a shield. Okay, so we got lots of shields and a double sword. I think what we can do with this is almost exactly what I was hoping for. We can double shield here, and then we can shield sword here, and then we can activate this all at 1 time. This is going to be awesome. All right, here's what's going to happen. I am going to gain +2 defense, so I'm going to be at 4 defense, and then I get to add a red -1 chip to him. So we'll grab that right here, and we'll give this to him. That's a fight chip, sorry. A negative defense chip to him. He's going to gain a negative defense chip. We'll put that on his card. Now at this point, I am going to, those are going to be our 2 action points as well, right there. I'm going to activate this, doing 4 points of damage. He's got -1 defense, so he's going to take 3. And I'm going to use the chain over here and grab the green cube. Because if I can ever chain that, that's going to be awesome. So we're going to get our own green cube for our action points. And that's going to be all we're going to do here because I don't have any more chips to draw. But I think we're going to set ourselves up pretty well for the next turn. I do have to return both of these to the board there. But that's okay. We are still going to do some damage, so we're going to do a total of 4. And since he has -1 defense, he's going to take 1, 2, 3. I've refreshed my action cubes, and now I have an extra action cube. So when I'm drawing, I can actually draw more black chips out of my bag. Sadly, he's going to remove this chip. I wish I could stay there longer than that turn. And he's going to draw his next card and see what he has got. He has himself a disrupting dagger chip thing again. All right, so he's going to do 1 plus the damage, so he's going to do 4 damage, and he's going to gain another green one. Oh my gosh, it's the same card I just saw. I don't know why I'm so surprised by this. Gets another green one. That's going to be the end of his turn. The funny thing is, I actually have 4 defense, so he's not going to do any damage. I got plus 2 defense from my card, Take Cover. Sadly, I do have to remove 2 sword chips from my bag, and I had only 2 green sword chips in there. Dang it. That was going to be so good if I could have used those. Oh boy. Oh well. We'll get them back. We'll get them back. I have to discard these two over to here, put this on cooldown, and flip these two cards back to the other side. Well, one's going to go to a normal side, and this one's going to go back to a regular side. I'm going to remove this cube. I don't have that anymore. And I don't have any chips in here. That was actually kind of funny that he made me do that. I was actually going to have to take a damage to put the chips back in here, but I don't have to because he made me take those 2 chips out. I get myself a defense chip, which is going to be good. I got myself a double sword. That's fantastic. And I got myself a sword chip. All right, that's going to be pretty good. The funny thing is, I get this double sword, but I really can't do much more than just attack with it. Here's what we're going to do. As I say, and not much I can do with it. Yes, there is. I can use it right there. That's going to cost me 2 action points. I can also put this right there. It's going to cost me that action point that I have. That's awesome. I'm going to grab a green chip from here. And the cool thing is, check this out. I am going to be able to, I can either chain into another shield, or I could draw 2 chips from the bag and be able to use them right now. Now, I'm out of action points, and the only chip I have is this one, which I'm going to activate my sword with. So, funny enough, I don't think it's going to be worth it to be able to draw more chips right now from the bag. So, instead, I'm going to chain this one and grab this shield and another shield. So, I've got lots of shield tokens in there, and that's going to be my turn. Now, the thing is, I could have activated this if I had more chips or more action points, but I just don't have them. So we're going to put these into our bag, giving us some more defense, and we're going to hit him with this, and we're going to hit him with a normal attack. Now, sadly, he's got full up defense, so I'm only going to do a total of 5 damage from my critical attack. Minus 2 is 3. 1, 2, 3. He's at 9. And then my normal attack is going to be 3. Minus 2 is 1. I will refresh all of my action cubes. And I also get to give myself 1 defense before we draw our next death card here, because he has 5 action cubes. That's ridiculous. Poison in bag. Oh, that's terrible. So I'm going to take a poison token and put it into my bag. Poison tokens, when they're drawn, are going to instantly do me 1 damage, so I don't want to ever draw that. That's horrible. Then it's going to dash. So it's going to do 2 action cubes in order to attack with plus 1, discarding 2 random chips from the target's bag. Well, hopefully the poison chips. Then it's going to be opportunistic. It's going to reuse another token to draw 1 more card. So it's not going to end its turn because it was able to perform that. So I have to remove 2 random chips from my bag. Well, like I said, hopefully the poison chips. First one, oh, the first one's the poison chip. Well, that was awesome. Discard 2 random chips. The other one is going to be our black sword token. At this point, I am going to take some damage. He's going to hit me for 3 plus 1 is 4. I only have a 3 defense, so I'm going to take 1 damage. This little pukey little seer assassin still has 2 more action chips left. So let's see what he does now. He's going to Viper Strike for plus 2. If the attack hits, I get to deal, add 1 to the target. Oh, yuck. Well, the good news is it's going to use both of his action cubes to do this. So he's going to target me. He's going to do, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 damage, and I get another poison token. Or I should say poison chip into my bag. 5 minus 3 is going to be 2, so I'm at 5 health. I do have to place this into my bag, so now I've got that yucky thing in the bag. I'm going to put that in there. I'm going to discard this because this is no longer part. We'll get the rest of these all set up. We'll refresh that and flip these 2 cards back to their original side if I can actually get them out of here. I'll see if I can. There we go, just like that. Oh, and we'll put these into our discard area. I do have a health potion I could use, but I can't use it until after I draw my chips, from how I understand the order of operations here. So we're going to draw chips. Remember, I can draw until I get 3 black ones. So there's 1 black one. Let's see what else we get. 2 black ones. Oh, come on. There's some green shields in here. Let's get some of those. Yeah, there we go. Green shield. Come on. Oh, we got another shield. Darn. Let's hope the green shields will just keep coming. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to set ourselves up yet again. I think it's going to be a good one to do. We're going to play those there, and we're going to play this one right here. That's what we're going to do. We're going to do a shield. Oh, I can't do that because I don't have shields. Okay, we'll just do attack there, and we'll do another attack here. That'll be just fine. So we're going to play this one first to give myself a sword chip to put into my bag. That's what we're going to do. Then I am going to activate this one to give myself plus 2 defense, bringing it up to 4, and I get another green cube here. Now, these will go away at the end of the battle, but I do get to keep them for the whole battle, which is pretty awesome. So I'm going to use that one, then this, and chain into that. I think we're just going to go ahead and use this. I'm just going to use it because I don't know when I'm going to get that negative one, be able to use the negative to him back again. So we're just going to use this now to do 4 points of damage, and my little thing is flying all over. On top of that, I'm going to do 3 damage here as well. So he's going to get all his action cues back, and 4 minus that is 1, 2, and 3 minus that is 1. So we did a total, I guess, of 3 damage. That's not too bad. And we'll draw his next card because we'll then clean up our boards when it comes back around. He is going to do, what's this? Acidic Blade. That's going to be terrible. Oh my gosh, look at these poison tokens I'm adding. It goes another 1 action point to deal a total of 1, 2, 3, 4 damage. And it's going to add 2 poison tokens, toys and chips to the bag. Good news is I have 4 defense, so I'm not going to take any damage. Bad news is I have to put 2 more of these in my bag. That's no good. Now we are going to discard that chip, and we're going to discard these 2 as well. Put this one up here, and then this is going to go on cooldown. These 2 are going to flip to their primary and secondary here. Now, what I was really hoping to do is get this one flipped over as well, and I could have done 1, 2, 3, 4. I had the action cubes to do it if I could have drawn the right amount of chips, but sadly, it's not going to happen. But still, hopefully I can get some good attacks here. Now, I'm allowed to look at my bag whenever I want to, and all I see in there is poison and green chips. So these aren't going to help me, so I am going to take the 1 damage. Now, one thing I should have done, I am still learning the game. I should have used my health potion last turn, because remember, I can only use it after I draw, and there are so many poison chips in here. I guess technically I would still survive, so I can still legally do this, I guess. But if I draw all the poison chips out of there, I'm going to be at like 1 health, and that's going to be absolutely horrible. But we are going to take all of our discarded chips, and we're going to put them back into the bag. Now, of course, it does put another poison chip in there, and hopefully I can get rid of that somehow. We're going to mix all these up, and I get to draw up to 4 black chips out of this. So hopefully we get 4 black chips. That's what I really want. We got 1 green chip. I don't mind that. Green chips are good. I just want to see poison chips. Poison chips are bad. Oh, another green chip. That'll be good. Let's see. Come on. No green chips. No poison chips. I mean, no poison. So far, we're doing pretty good. Oh, poison chips. I'm going to lose 1 point of damage. Yuck. Let's keep going. Hopefully, we get some good ones here. Oh, look, a double sword. And I get to keep drawing. I love having stamina. Oh, my gosh. Look at this. Look at all the chips I get to draw. This is so much fun. Oh, another poison. I'm going to take a damage. Now, of course, the more you draw, the more chance you get of these stupid poison tokens. Oh, I drew all my poison tokens. Almost all my poison tokens. That's really bad. Oh, I did draw all my poison tokens. Lucky me. Oh, my gosh. That's horrible. But I did get 1 more sword. All right. So we are up to a ton of things. Now, here's our 1, 2, 3, 4 black chips. That is going to be the action point totals we have, and we got a couple extra to do. And oh my gosh, we drew all 4 of our poison chips. I'm gonna put them in my negative pile right over there. And sadly, we have an absolute astronomical amount of chips. There's not much I can do with them. I can do the 2 attack over there. I can do the 1 defense here. But sadly, I'm gonna run out of action cubes here. I only have 1 and 2 that I can use there. And the other ones are sadly it's gonna go to waste here. I'm gonna put 1 into my sword. And the other 3, see, now this is what I'm talking about. If I could have had the other side flipped, I could have used that other one with the other action cube, but I'm out of action cubes. So sad. But that's okay. At least we got to do what we wanted to do. I also could draw 2 more chips out of here, making it so that the bag is empty, which might not be a bad idea. The other option is I can put another shield token in here. Add 1 shield to Gregory's bag. And then I could add another shield token to Gregory's bag. So when I pull, I can get 4. I know exactly what I'll get. I'll get a sword and 3 shields. And the sword would go over, I could attack with, and the shields I could use here, or something of that nature. It's something we'd have to think about exactly. Huh, how do we want to do this? Draw these 2 chips now, which aren't going to be able to help me because I can only make 1 basic attack and they've used all the rest of my chips. Meanwhile, these 4 would go right back into my bag because it'd be empty and those poison tokens are killing me. I think we're going to do it this way. I think we're going to grab the shield token, the 2 shield chips, and hope that I can get through this okay. So we do a critical hit that does 3 plus 2 is 5. So I'm going to do a total of 3 damage. 1, 2, 3. And then my normal attack is a 3 minus 1 is 1. Oh my gosh, I'm so close to getting him. Oh, that's all I can do. We'll refresh our action cubes and discard all the green chips I have, which is going to be my shield and my sword that I use. But remember, now I've got all of those out of there now. So there's a good chance that unless he puts more poison chips in my bag, I should be just fine. Let's see what he is going to draw. He's going to draw himself a, goes up to the lowest, ending blow. It's going to cost him 3 action cubes, and it does 3 plus 4 is 7. Oh my gosh, I don't know if I have enough to do that. Oh, I forgot to use my healing potion. Well, I'm going to use my healing potion when I have one health. I totally would have used it, my healing potion. I don't know why I wouldn't. I only have one health. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I go back up to 6. Now I do have a total of 3 defense. I did get one from my guard, but he's going to do 7 points of damage. -3 is 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh my goodness, look at how close this is going to be. We have to discard our token here. Oh my gosh, I'm down to 2 health. Now the good news is we know what we're drawing this turn because we've stage set ourselves up. We're gonna flip these 2 cards, meaning that I should be able to get at least a damage through. There are no poison tokens in here. I'm choosing not to take a damage and I'm just gonna start drawing. I got a shield, a sword, and a shield, and I'm out of chips, so I'm not gonna draw anymore, which is fantastic. Let's see what we can get with these chips here. I should be able, this is right here is enough to kill him. That's enough to kill him right there. No matter what. I don't think there's anything else I can really do. That's all that damage I actually can do. I can't do any more damage, but 1 will be enough because I have 3 attack and he only has 2 defense. So that's going to bring him to 0. Oh my gosh, that's so close. I only have 2 health, but we do get to reap the rewards. Let's see the rewards we get for taking a level 2 assassin that almost destroyed us. We are going to get ourselves, oh my gosh, 10 lux and 10 sil. Oh my gosh, we are rolling in money. We are at 13 sil and 16 lux. The lux, remember, is our experience points, and sil is our gold in this game. Now, like I said, this dial likes to spin on me, so I got to make sure I remember how much I have. 13. There we go. That's awesome. Now it's time to clean up this fiasco of a battle, which was pretty awesome. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to clean up the enemy board. I'm going to get rid of any extra cubes that they have. We're just going to clean it all up. We're going to get rid of our enemy, and we're going to get rid of the enemy deck, and we're going to put that back into the box where we found it. That'll be fantastic. I don't ever want to see him again unless I'm more powerful. At this point, the interesting thing is now I'm going to remove all of my green chips. So these are going to go back in here. But the black chips and the purple chips, these 4 poison chips, are all going to go into my bag. So I'm going to be drawing those again. Also, we have to flip our S cards back to our P side. And I think that's about all we have to do. Oh, there's one more thing. We have to get rid of our green cubes as well. We're not allowed to keep those. I'm just going to put this blue cube off to that. There we go. That is the way. And then this is gone. I'm going to return this to the box as well. We have used our healing potion. It does say now, if victorious, proceed to chapter 1.6, victory below. And as you can see, it is told by Forteller.
As the assassin slumps to the ground, a small panic erupts in the crowd around you. Before things get too out of hand, you slip into an alleyway and get lost in the many side streets of Silny. Before long, you reach the King's Gate. It seems that luck is with you, and the gate is still open. Word of the killing has not yet spread to the wall. You blend into the crowd and walk out of Silny, alive, but shaken.
Let's check out that ghost skull mask. And at this point, we're gonna move Gregory's ship to node 35 and proceed to 14 and read chapter 1.8. Here's our goat skull mask. This thing is huge. Once per turn, you may mulligan 1 draw chip. That is out of control. I love it. We're gonna put it right here. And this is gonna be the 1 accessory we're gonna be able to use if we ever go into battle. Now, of course, we could put it in our satchel over here, but then if we're in any type of narrative phase or we're in any of the combats, you can't just switch these out during that time. So you have to have everything planned out before that happens. We'll also place our guy down on node 35, which is right there. This is called Coastal Road in the eyes of Grigory.
You walk along the road to Fort Strazh, pondering what your next move will be. Should you try to persuade the guard to join you? Join you for what? To march on Silny and kill Temnota? Overthrow the king? You are ashamed of the thought as it crosses your mind. The truth is, you have no idea what to do next. You stop walking and close your eyes. Maybe the voice can tell you something. You take a deep breath and clear your mind. But before anything can happen, the sound of footsteps approaching from behind grabs your attention.
Captain Grigory, sir?
You turn to see Alek standing before you at full attention.
Alek, what are you doing here? You should be guarding the wall.
My shift was over and I was in the barracks when the rumors started pouring in. Captain Grigory has been exiled. Captain Grigory was seen fleeing the city.
Alek stops as he notices the dirt and blood staining your clothes.
Did you get in a fight? Captain, what's going on?
You look Alek up and down and sigh.
The rumors are true.
You can see that Alek is bursting with questions, but he lets the silence stretch out.
It's a long story,
you finally say, turning back to the road. Alek catches up to you and matches your stride.
I think I may understand more than you think.
Alek carefully reaches into his belt purse and pulls out a glowing stone.
Alek, are you...
Stonebound,
he finishes.
How? When?
A few weeks ago, I heard the voice and I became stonebound. I had a vision of a great valley where other stonebound were gathering, but I felt the voice telling me to wait for something. And then I saw you.
Alek pauses, waiting for you to take the lead.
Alek, I'm not sure what to tell you. I tried to reason with King Karst, and I only managed to get myself exiled. I'm headed to Fort Strazh for supplies, but after that, I don't know where I'm headed.
Well, wherever it is, we'll go there together.
Next it says Grigory heals HP to 20 and all negative chips in his bag are removed and placed back in the supply. That's probably the greatest thing I have ever read in any narrative book I have ever experienced. Because I'm at 2 health and look at all these poison chips I have in my bag. We are going to get rid of all the poison chips. Yep, that's all of them. That is a total of 4. These things can all go out the door. No, sadly they can't go out the door. I do have to put these all back into our tray and we might gain them again. Hopefully not. I don't ever want to fight an assassin again. We're going to reset our hit points to 20, which is fantastic. We're going to replace Gregory's chip with the Gregory and Alek miniature on node 35. Okay, we've been doing that the whole time. Don't care. Love the miniature. Didn't need to use the chip. We must also use their bus chips alternate. Okay, so I could use their chips if I want to, but why would you do that when you got an awesome miniature? So at this point, we will put Alek back on the miniature just like that. There's these little holes in there where you can place them onto the miniature. So we're all set, our characters are both ready to go. That is fantastic, we'll put them back on node 35. Alek is now part of the adventure. Follow the game setup with 2 guards listed on page 17 in the rulebook. So we'll go over everything he has. The next part of the book lists everything he's supposed to gain and what chips he's gonna use and things of that nature. And I'll just go over those instead of reading them from the book. The first thing we'll do is set up this part of the player board. We have a iron short sword, a guard's tunic, both 1 starred. These are gonna allow us to use 1 chip to be able to do a normal attack. His attack is 2. He has 1 defense, so he's not as good as the captain straight up, but maybe there's some powers and abilities that'll help him out in the future. We do have 20 health, and we start with 2 action points. And look, we got our health potion back. Moving over to this side of the board, we're going to set up his abilities. We have Crimson Tonic, Corellian Elixir, and Golden Potion. The interesting thing about this is you are going to notice that these are all on their primary ability, but they do not have this symbol, which means these do not flip as we use them. You're just gonna be able to use them to do what they do on the bottom from how I understand it. So we can use like 1 attack and an action point to add 1 health to Alek or ally's bag. We can empower this by adding +1 to both bags, 1 +1 health chip. Empower is the special kind of ability that he gets like Grigory. Empower allows you when you have the ability combine, which we'll see probably pretty soon. That's I think his first power he's able to get. This gives the player the option to trigger the effect of Empower from 1 of the potion abilities that are found on these ability cards. Now the potion ability card does not need to be activated in order to use the Empower effect listed on the card. And each one of these has an Empower effect, which is kind of cool. This one will let us add a chip for, was it, sword and shield to Alex's or an ally's bag, and Empower I can draw 3 chips from Alex's bag. So it's kind of giving him the ability to gain more of those chips. The next one is going to gain a stamina cube, which we've already found is absolutely amazing. So we want to make this as many times as possible. We can empower to also give an ally a token cube as well. So that might be probably our big winner right there. Of course, it also takes the most chips to be able to do. Alek also has a stonebound ability as well. It's called Reinforce. That is going to be signified by the fact that he has an obsidian stone here. We're going to take a purple one and put it there to signify that stone. Reinforce allows you to attack an enemy for +1 attack, and while this is active, I get plus one defense, so that'll help him a lot. And here's the obsidian stone right here. So we're going to place this underneath our sword, and we'll be able to add this particular chip to the bag. So that's our sword and shield chip, which will help activate that one up here. That's going to be super, super good. So we'll place that particular chip into our bag, along with two attack and one defense. So he's able to pull out two chips right now with his activation cubes. So hopefully we could probably get that train rolling to get the stamina things pretty quick. We'll continue in the narrative book. It says that we have Fort Strazh here. The Strazh, which is going to be our 1.9. It says to move the guard to node 40 and follow the instructions on the exploration phase. So we're going to do an exploration phase. And then once that's complete, we're going to move to 48 and place the Strazh minimap on the table and move the guards there. And we'll read narrative chapter 1.9. We'll draw into our bag here to see what narrative event we, or not narrative, but our bag here to see what we get. We have found ourselves a two skull enemy. That's awesome. I'm guessing that's gonna be a little bit easier to handle now that we have two people with us, but who knows, because each one of these nodes has different encounters found inside the book. We are on node 40. We're gonna be fighting a brigand marauder and a brigand archer. And before I reach in the bag, I probably should have moved my miniature to node 40. First, we'll set up our brigand marauder. He has himself two action cubes, and he has seven health with a total of one attack and one defense. Next, we have the brigand archer, which is going to be interesting because this person has the same attack defense value and only one action cube. The thing that's going to make this a unique battle is this is technically slot three, so that means that this is sitting in front of slots one and two. In order to attack this particular creature, we have to take out everybody in slots one and two, and that would then push down three and four, or we would charge into slots three and four and attack them. I hope that makes sense. So in order to get to this character, we have to defeat the brigand marauder first. Now that we have two people in our party, I just again want to go through these really quick here. We're going to check the check equipped accessories for bonuses. That is not going to happen. We didn't discard any of those chips. We don't have any. We have to choose a guard to activate. Now at this point, I can choose either Alek or I can choose Grigory. And then the interesting difference about that is, of course, who is going to gain that aggro chip at the end. Whichever one activates last is going to have that aggro chip. So I think with Alex's one defense, we're going to have him go first and see how he does. He has a total of two action points, so we'll grab out two chips here. And we know there's nothing funny about any of these. We've got a sword, and the other chip we have is the sword and shield one. That's fantastic. We are going to use these chips to activate his guard abilities. He has two action points, so he'll be able to activate both of these. And I'm allowed to add a green health chip to Alex's bag or an ally's bag. We're going to give it to Grigory because he's going to have that the aggro token, so it might make a difference. The problem is if he draws that during his turn, it's going to pretty much be null and void, but that's okay. I think we'll still be doing okay. I then can go ahead and use this to gain one extra stamina cube that may not help me for the first set of turns here, because I only have two more chips in my bag, I think. And so it's not really going to help me to have three, but coming into the future turns, this will help quite a bit. I could use this if I want to, but I think I'm going to save it for next turn, because we do know we have at least one more attack chip in the bag, which then we can use this and maybe this to help out. We'll see how this all transpires. All right, that's the end. Now, sadly, he does not have the ability to empower anything yet. He doesn't have that combine ability, but hopefully we'll get that pretty soon. With Alek done, we'll go to Grigory. Grigory has two action tokens as well. So we have to draw two chips. He got a defense and he has a sword. That's fantastic. Let's get the ball rolling. We're going to do our patented start maneuver, which we're going to put one cube, one token there, one token there. Call those our actions. We're going to add one defense token to the bag, and we're going to add two sword tokens because we're able to chain these abilities, giving us a total of three new chips into our bag, which can be absolutely awesome. At this point, I could activate my cross slash. The cross slash is going to give me an extra attack, which is going to be four, and it would hit all enemies, and that does include enemies in the back row. When it says all enemies, it is all enemies. But we're going to save that, I believe, for a next fight, or the next turn, I should say. Now that we've activated both of our guards, we'll move our action cubes back up to the unexhausted area. He's got three that are going to move back to the unexhausted area, and I've given myself that boost in defense. At this point, I will also place my aggro token on Grigory to help with any ties. With our turn complete, we'll go through the enemies really quick here. We will start by activating the enemy in slot one. None of these pertain. I will draw an AI card and do what it says and continue on. And we'll activate the remaining enemies in slot two, three, and four. So if we had an enemy in slot two, for example, we'd do one, two, three. If we had one in one and four, we'd do one, then four. So you do have to or activate them in the order of what they show up in that book. And then we'll refresh their action points for the enemies and move on. The Marauder in slot one will fire for attack first. Let's see what we have. It says Brigand Marauder is going to choose a target lowest defense. Well, sadly, that does not help with the aggro token. And all my plan just went out the window because he's not attacking Gregory, which is what I was hoping. He's going to attack with a sword thrust using one of his action cubes. We'll slide that over. And it's going to be a plus two damage attack. So he's going to do three damage. And the attack, if the attack deals no damage, draw a card. Well, it's going to be dealing a damage, so that means it will end its turn. Yeah, this is going to do three damage to Alek. Alek has no extra defense because he decided not to activate my reinforce ability. So he is going to take two damage because he only has one defense. Moving over to our archer only has one action cube. Oh, perfect. This one's a good attack person. The highest defense. I love it. Flaming arrow. Oh, no. What's this? What? Seriously? Oh, my goodness. This is amazing. It's going to cost one action point. We'll move that over. And it's going to do a plus two attack. So it's going to be for three damage. Then look at this. After attack, target loses three health. End of turn. No ifs, ands, or buts about it. Just burn, baby. Burn. Good news, bad news. Good news, I get to soak up all the damage from the actual attack. Bad news, one, two, three, I still take three damage. Moving to the cleanup phase, we'll discard all our chips from the guard ability, flip over any cards that need to flip, then we'll discard any chips from positive or negative chips from on guard ability dashboards, and any purple chips are moved to the discard, green are moved to the supply, and we'll move exhausted speaking stones to ready slots, then activate the speaking stone gems on the card to the exhausted slot. So we'll discard these two cards and we'll flip these abilities, which is going to be fantastic. And remember how good that one is. I think that's something we want to try to have happen. We did not use our cross slash, but that's okay. I have a plan with that. And now remember, for Alek, we do not get to flip these cards. They're just going to stay exactly like that. We're just going to discard the two tokens. At this point, we'll again start with our characters. The first thing we have to do is discard any blue chips on our board or cubes on our board. We're going to draw our last two tokens. It really doesn't matter what order I draw these in because they're just a sword and a shield, I think. Here we are. Sword and shield. I only have two action cubes, sadly, so I can't do too much more. What we're going to do, though, is we are going to add the sword and shield to Alex's bag. It's going to cost us a... Oh, it's only going to cost us a shield. That's fantastic. So we're going to add those to our bag. We're going to grab a shield token, and we're going to grab a sword token and add these to Alex's bag. Or I could add it to an ally's bag, but I... Oh, maybe I should give it to Gregory. That'd mean he'd have a monstrous amount of chips he could draw. But he only has two action cubes still, not three. He's got three. He can't really use all the cubes he's got. So we're going to give those to Alek. He's going to gain those into his bag. And then we're going to use our last attack action cube to attack. And we're going to use our reinforce ability this time, which is going to give us plus one to our attack, which means our attack value is going to be three. And we are able to, while active, I do get plus one defense. So we're at two defense now instead of three. And that one ability is going to cost me an action cube. I can't hit the archer yet, so we're just going to do two damage to the Brigand Marauder because he has one defense. It's time for Gregory to draw some chips. Let's see how he does. He is drawing himself. Oh, he got the heart chip. That's good. He's going to gain one health. He's up to 18. We'll keep drawing here. Another green chip. I love green chips. Keep drawing. We got a double sword. And what else do we get? We got another green chip. Oh my gosh, this is so good. And then, oh my God, I got Sword City here. Now looking at the chips I have, they are a lot of swords here. I was really hoping for at least one shield here to maybe activate this to get me my extra, a stamina point. So I'm going to use this ability here. Once per turn, you may mulligan one drawn chip. I'm going to mulligan the green sword chip there. And we're going to see if we can get a better one. Let's draw into our bank here, mix this up a little bit, and hopefully we can get one of the shield tokens. That's my plan here. Let's see what we get. We have gotten ourselves another sword chip. So that didn't help at all. What we'll do is we're going to just take out a dude, I think is the plan here. We're going to use this double sword to make it a shield. We're going to use this sword to do that. Then we're going to use a sword on our main normal attack. And then this is just going to, I'm not going to be able to use this. That's just going to kind of sit there. And I'm going to activate my cross slash ability this time as well. Now, sadly, it would have been nice to be able to chain this and attack an enemy with an extra attack, but I didn't get the defense chip, so I was kind of hoping for to make that happen. But that's okay. Let's see how much damage we can do. The first thing we can do is give a negative one chip to one of our enemies. I'm not going to give it to this one. I'm going to give it to the archer because our cross slash is going to do 4 points of damage and he has one defense. So he's going to take 3, 1, 2, 3. Then with my regular attack, I will do 3 points of damage with his one defense. He will take 1, 2. He is dead. And we instantly gain ourselves 3 sil and 2 lux, bringing our sil total up to 16, which is fantastic. And our lux value is going to go from 16, 17, 18. So we now have 18 lux. The last thing we're going to do is 4 damage to this one because remember our cross slash does 4 damage to all enemies. I technically should have done the damage for cross slash on everybody first before I did his last attack, but for recording purposes, it's just easier to do it this way. 1, 2, 3, 4. The archer is down to 3. The archer then gets to discard this ability. I get to refresh all of my exhausted action cubes, and we'll move into the brigand's turn now. This person, the archer, is going to draw a card and see what she... Oh, she's have all her action cubes. See what she does. She is going to choose the person with the highest defense again. And this time, okay, let's see, her highest defense. Now, he's also got the aggro token that Grigory does. And he has a total defense of 2 right now. And the and Alex has a total of 2 as well. So they are the same. So this time the aggro token is going to play into effect. So he is going to target Grigory for this particular attack. Let's see what he does. Piercing shot. It's going to cost us 1 stamina point or action point. Sorry. So we're going to move that over there for +2. Add 2 -1 chips to the target bag. Oh, that's horrible. All right, we'll give those to him. And then we are going to take a total of 3 points of damage. I have 2 defense, so I am only going to take 1. And at this point, I will put 2 red -1 chips into Grigory's bag. We'll refresh our action cube on our Brigand Archer, and I will take away all of our green chips we did not use and place them back in the supply. We will then discard any of our action chips that we used during the last turn for both of our characters. We'll also flip any of the cards we used. We use this one, and we also have to get that back into its cooldown. We'll do the same thing for him. We'll discard our chips and put that in cooldown. Alek is going to go first this time. He is going to pull out chips until he reaches 2. He's got himself a defense and a sword, and then my bag is empty, so that's all I can do. I have to stop drawing. Totally fine. I'm totally set with these 2 things. Now, I could have taken 1 damage to refill my bag if I wished to, but I didn't want to because I kind of have a plan. I say kind of because they usually don't happen as well as I'm hoping. I'm going to put a chip there and a chip there. I'm going to give a defense and a sword chip to, I think it's Alex or an ally's bag. So we're going to give these both to Grigory, and we're going to give the health chip to Grigory as well. Those will be both 2 of my 3 actions. I don't have any other chips to use to bring to use the extra action. So interestingly enough, I need to try to get this over to my ally more than I need to keep it with him. He doesn't really seem to be using that too well. We will add those 3 chips to his bag and we'll start drawing out here. We have drawn ourselves a shield. Now hopefully I can get some of these green chips because I really need the green chips to come out of here so that I can do enough damage to kill this thing. Hopefully we'll see how this goes. Oh, there's a -1 defense chip. Hopefully that doesn't matter to us. I got a health chip. Awesome. I need that. I'm instantly going to take a health. There we go. And let's keep on going here. I think they're all green chips in here. Yeah, all green and red. I could have maybe done this a little bit differently because I think this is going to be overkill. And sadly, I did pull a ton of green chips out of here. So our bags are going to start back at normal, which might not have been the greatest thing. But I have -2 defense right now, which is absolutely no good. I'll put 0. So there we go. That's fantastic. But I don't think it's going to matter. I think we're going to eliminate this particular character. So we have all of these chips, but sadly, the one thing we need is damage. And I can only do 3 with this, and I don't have any way of taking away his defense. And the brigand is sitting at 3 defense. So if I just do a normal attack, he's going to be having 1 defense left. So that's no good. So I actually do have to use all of these chips, converting 2 shields into a sword to use my critical attack. And since I only have 2 action points, that's all I can do. It'd been really nice to be able to activate this as well, to be able to put one of these green tokens into my bag so I'd have it for my next battle. But that's not going to happen. Instead, I'm going to do 5 points of damage to this brigand archer, which means the brigand archer is going to go to Dead City. 1, 2, 3, this archer's dead. I'm going to gain some stuff. We gained ourselves 3 sil and 2 lux, bringing our sil total up to 19. And our lux total is now 20. So we'll put a 2 and a 0. We got 20 lux, which is pretty sweet. See if I can spin these things the right way. There we go, 20 lux. Moving to the end of battle, we'll return all ships to the enemy dashboard back to the supply. We'll collect the rewards from defeated enemies, which I did. Maybe I should have waited until after they were both dead. I apologize if I did that wrong. Return enemy and AI cards to their index box. Return all black and purple chips on both guard dashboards and ability dashboards back to the guard's bags. So we're gonna take all of those chips that we used for Grigory, and we'll put those back into his bag, and then we'll take all of the purple and black chips. Remember that Alex does have a purple chip, so we're gonna add that plus his other three chips into his bag, so he is all set to go. There we go. And then we're going to return all green and red chips on both guard dashboards and ability dashboards back to the supply. So good news, I do get to get rid of these. If they were still in my bag, I think they go with me, because it doesn't say anything about discarding them from the bag. And then we're gonna return any AP cubes that are green to the supply, and we'll fill up the guard ability cards back to their primary slots and move all speaking stones to their ready position. So good news, bad news, yes, all of these go back to the supply, including our health chip that we drew as well. But I think that health chip coming through is gonna be awesome. I'm also gonna move this to the active ability. I will move Alex's to the active ability as well, and he also has to move his green and chip shield chips to the supply as well. And that's gonna be the end. We'll move on to the story. The other thing I had to do is flip all these to their primary sides. Now that we're at node 40, we will read 1.9 for Fort Strazh.
As you walk alongside the captain, you periodically glance over, trying to decipher what he's thinking. His face is an unreadable mask, but you can sense the determination emanating from him with each step. You manage to keep mostly silent, allowing the captain space for his thoughts, and then suddenly, you arrive. The high walls and towers of Fort Strazh always managed to make you feel safe. Standing before them now, they seem cold and menacing. The usual hubbub surrounding the fort is gone now, replaced by icy silence. Grigory lets the silence stretch out before shouting,
"Open the gate! Would you have your captain stand out in the cold?"
A dark figure comes to stand above the gate, leering down at you.
"Captain, that's an interesting thing to call yourself. I had a little bird tell me that you are captain no longer."
"Akev, then you also heard that the king is graciously allowing me to gather supplies before my exile."
"That's Captain Akev to you. And yes, I will allow you to gather a few supplies. After all, I still know how to follow King's orders. I'll even let you bring your little friend."
As the gate cracks open, Captain Grigory speaks to you.
"You're sure you want to cast your lot with me? There's no going back from here."
"My lot is with the Stonebound, and that means you. This is bigger than even Isofar now."
Captain Grigory takes a look at you and nods before stepping through the gate.
And at this point, we'll move the guards to Fort Strazh's courtyard minimap and proceed to page 16. Here's our minimap for Fort Strazh. And again, we came in through 48, which is the north gate, but it's telling us to place ourselves in the courtyard, and we'll continue on with the story.
As you pass through the gate, you are surprised to see the courtyard filled with what must be every guard at the fort. They seem to be split into two groups. The larger group surrounding Captain Akev, facing down a much smaller group near the west gate, perhaps 20 guards. Akev locks eyes with you, only speaking when you are a few paces away.
"Grigory, it's so good to see you again. Tell me, how has my son been doing under your command?"
The sudden shift in tone throws you. Your thoughts flick back to Yuri, young and eager, and now stonebound.
"Yuri is young, but he has a strong heart. With more experience, I believe he will make an excellent leader someday."
Akev sneers.
"I must tell you, I'm glad that he won't be getting that experience from you. You see, you've always struck me as a bit dull."
At this, the guards behind Akev begin to chuckle.
"I think my boy Yuri needs a strong hand to guide him now. Someone who isn't content to merely guard the borders."
"Isofar is safe and prosperous. I do everything to ensure that it remains that way.
The Falman threat has been hanging over our heads for generations. You were never willing to do what needed done. But I will end the threat once and for all.
You are speaking of war with Falman? That is madness!
Well, Grigory, the secret to being a truly great leader just so happens to be a little bit of madness.
Akev smiles and turns to the guard nearest him.
Throw him his supplies and send him on his way. The good captain, ex-captain, is boring me.
The guard lobs a small pouch which you snatch out of the air. You turn over the pouch, and a single gold coin falls into your palm.
For services rendered. Goodbye, Grigory. Don't forget to bring your pet soldier with you when you leave.
A shout bursts forth from the small group of guards clumped near the gate.
Grigory is the rightful captain!
Immediately, 200 swords are drawn and leveled at the rogue group of guards. You desperately try to intervene.
No, my friends! I am your captain no longer. King Karst himself has ordered it. The best thing you can do for Isofar now is to serve honorably under Akev.
Grigory. I just don't know what to do with you. Since I'm feeling generous today, I won't kill you and your little sycophants where you stand. Instead, I offer you my mercy.
As Akev speaks, he singles out the small group of rebel guards with a slow sweep of his sword.
You will join your precious captain in his exile. You will wander as outcasts in a foreign land until you die alone and forgotten. Your children will forget your faces. Your families will live in disgrace and curse your name, and your line will end. You will be erased from history. And if any of you are ever foolish enough to try and come back here, you and your entire family will be hauled to the nearest town square and slaughtered as a warning to those who would betray Isofar.
The only thing that softens the blow is the hope that there will be no bloodshed today. Rather than risking any further discussion with Akev, you simply turn to usher Alek and the new guards out of the gate. Something is off about Akev. You take a final look at him, but the person staring back at you is no longer the Akev you knew.
At this point, we'll move our guards to node 63 and proceed to page 17 and read chapter 1.11. That was a very short-lived minimap. We'll place our guys out on node 63, and we'll proceed on with the story. 63 is right out Ford Straza here, and let's see what happens.
The mood is somber as you walk the coastal road with your fellow exiles. Grigory thought it best to get as far away from Fort Straz as possible before stopping to come up with a more permanent plan. You have taken the time to get to know some of the guards better. There are a few familiar faces in the group. Bairnt, who helps in the smithy sometimes. Kellen, an excellent swordsman. Danielle, always ready with a clever remark, but nice enough to get away with it. Other faces are familiar, but you can't place names with them. But there, speaking with Grigory, is a face you've never seen before. A new recruit, maybe? As you approach them, the new recruit turns and greets you.
Ah, welcome, Alek. It's nice to finally meet you.
It's nice to meet you too. Have we met before? I mean, no, I guess you just implied we haven't, but then, how do you know my name?
When you get around as much as I do, you get to know a lot of things. Rather than bore you with how I know your name, I should think you'd be more interested in where we go from here.
You look to Grigory.
What is he talking about, Captain? Who is this?
I think it best if you just show him what you showed me.
Very well.
He stoops down and plucks an ordinary stone off the ground and holds it before you. Slowly, the stone begins to change before your eyes. A faint light emanates from the center of the stone, building in intensity until you are forced to shield your eyes. There is a sudden flash of light that pierces your eyelids, and then it's over. When you open your eyes, a steadily glowing speaking stone rests in the man's hands.
It's a speaking stone! But how did you know it was there?
It wasn't there. The stones appear when there's a need.
The man pauses before continuing.
You have heard the voice speaking to you from the stones, yes?
Yes.
No need to fear, Alek. I am an emissary for the one behind that voice.
The man pauses, allowing the words to sink in. The sudden realization of the man's importance slams into you. Now that you are aware, you can sense the power flowing from him. You awkwardly stumble, simultaneously trying to bow and shake his hand. Failing both, you manage to ask,
Sire, what do we call you?
I am no king, merely a guide.
The man raises his gaze, and you realize that everyone has stopped speaking, and all eyes are locked on the stranger.
You may call me Dunamis. I have been sent to you because the need is great. There is a darkness that has long plagued the edges of this world. You have seen its effects in men like Captain Akev, but this is just the beginning. This darkness, Tenebris, is no longer content to hide in the shadows. It has chosen this time to strike out at all of Telios. Its goal is to bring every man, woman, child, and beast under its sway. But you have access to a greater power. In time, you will learn to use this power to its full potential. Until that time, a place has been set aside for you to gather your strength. Follow me, and I promise you will not meet the Shadow unprepared.
That was a lot of narrative. Thank you for all bearing with me on that. We'll move in to place our narrative chip on node 102. Also during the narrative, we were able to gain one sill. So not only are we at 20 lux, but we were also at 20 sill that we may be able to use in the future. The tutorial is now complete. We're going to begin the exploration page starting on page 18 of the rulebook for instructions on how to do that. We've been doing it for a while, so I think we got it. Now that you have completed the few battles, you may have enough lux to unlock something in one of the guards' skill trees. We recommend unlocking Alex's combine ability, which then would allow him to use those in power on those cards, which would be pretty awesome. Let's see what it says here, which costs 10 lux. This card allows you to use the keyword in power, which I was just talking about. See page 28 and 29 in the rulebook for more info on our skill tree. Here is our skill trees for both of our characters. There's a couple things I want to go over with these skill trees because they're super cool. First off, we're in chapter 1, so any box you see here is going to cost us 10 lux in order to get. If you notice, we already have our cross slash and our reinforcement checked off. They do recommend that you either photocopy this or you can go to their website and you can print off a copy of this for free on their website. I'll put a link to that in the description of this video if you're looking for a way to get a copy of this. This one is what they recommend to do, so I think we're going to do 10 lux and we're going to gain that particular ability right there called Combine. Another cool thing about this skill tree is that if you notice the twos here are above these ones, you cannot go through into the two area here until you're in chapter 2, which I think is a cool way of doing this. It leaves you the ability to have to stay inside a particular area, or not area, but you can't break out of these areas and to become more powerful than out-level the chapter. That's what I'm trying to say. So I really think that's a cool ability with these skill trees. I can't just take this one right here, this one here with 20 and then just power through and go all the way up. I have to stay inside the chapter that I am when it comes to leveling. I think that's really cool. Now I do have 10 more luck essence or lux essence, and I'm not sure what to do with that. I am going to leave it up to my Patreon supporters to decide what we're going to use our 10 lux for. Some of the options are defense chips for Grigory, offense chips for Grigory, or again, defense and offense chips for Alex. Gregory does have already 3 and 2 chips respectively in his bag, where Alex only has 2 and 1 respectively. So maybe a defense chip might not be a bad idea for Alex because it doesn't increase his defense. Now, I do want you to realize this. Getting this chip does not increase his defense. The only way you can increase your actual stats is by something that has a +1 on here. For example, I can get +1 health if I get to this node here. But if I have a chip like this, this is a health chip that goes in my bag. It does not raise my health stat. I hope that makes sense. So to sum it all up, we're going to take this combine ability, and I'm going to have my Patreon supporters decide if we should either get a defense or offensive chip for which one of our characters. If you're interested in helping decide that, please check out a link in the description. It'll have a link to my Patreon that you can become part of and help us decide what happens in the game. For example, in this game, I'm going to be looking for help going through the skill trees for our particular characters. So in essence, Lux essence, I guess I could say, you're going to be helping decide the fate of our heroes. Now, if you're watching this on the One-Stop Co-op Shop, please check out Meet Me at the Table. That is also going to be a link in the description below, and from there you can find the Patreon if you're interested in helping decide how to support these characters. If you're also watching this on the One-Stop Co-op Shop, join that Patreon, and they're awesome guys, and I'm super proud to be part of that team. So our book has told us we have to put a narrative chip on 102. That's way down here. We have to make our way all the way to 102 to begin the next part of our narrative. The world is technically open to us at this point. We can go wherever we want, which is kind of a cool way of doing this. So now I could visit this town, for example, and take part in some things there. We can travel up over to this town if you wanted to. We can go straight to this area, and there's all different things we can do. Notice these green nodes. These are where you can gain some resources, but I do not have the ability to do it yet because I don't have one of these items. Maybe we can pick one up at a particular town or something. Also, you can boat down these if you're on blue spaces. These blue spaces connect faster, but if you ever find in a combat on the blue nodes, no matter what it says, they'll always be an ambush encounter. So I do want you to bear in mind that. I think we're going to take a nice stroll down memory lane down to 102. That's going to be our plan, and interestingly enough, we're going to do that in the next video. So that is going to be most likely a video on how to do an exploration area or stage of this game, which is gonna be pretty sweet. So we're gonna be moving around all these nodes. We're gonna be finding some cool things, I bet. We're gonna be playing to what the game has to offer outside of the narrative in the next video. Our book does say, though, upon arrival at node 102, place the Fort Istra minimap on the table, remove all building pieces from the board and place them aside. Move the guards to Fort Istra's north gate and proceed to page 19 in chapter 2.1. So we'll be moving to chapter 2. This is the end of chapter 1, so we are, like I said, in the exploration phase, but we have to use chapter 2 index when it comes to seeing what particular things are going to happen to us inside the game Isofarian Guard. This is going to be super cool. And here's a picture of our brave guards that we're going to be continuing the adventure of in the next video. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed the playthrough of the Isofarian Guard. If you did, don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit that bell so we'll see you know when more Isofarian Guard comes out. Also, please feel free to leave anything in the comments below. I would love to hear from everyone. We're going to be moving into the second chapter, which I believe is going to be a lot less narrative driven, as the first one was a complete tutorial of kind of telling you how this whole story begins. But we're going to be doing a lot of exploring in the next video, and who knows what could happen. All those different chips we could pull could cause completely different things from anybody else that plays this game. Not only that, if we pull enough of those of certain chips, those compass chips, we might be taking advantage of some of these cards that could be that are going to lead us down different things or have different things happen to our guys. There's so many random things that could happen during our travels. I think it'll be a lot of fun to watch. Now, if you're interested in supporting the channel, you can join my Patreon. The Patreon link is in the description of this video. The ones that have already joined the Patreon are located here on the screen. Thank you so much for your patronage. It means the world to me. Some of the perks that the people get in our Patreon is they get to see the videos usually a day or two before they come out for everybody else commercial free. At least all of my playthroughs I try to do. Also, my Patreon supporters do get a chance to influence what happens in the game. For example, in this one, I will need some help deciding what to do with that 10 Lux essence moving into the next video. Also, in our playthroughs, they help decide what characters come in. Also, they can help us decide what we're going to paint during our live painting streams that we do usually about once a week. So there you have it, the Isofarian Guard. Again, thank you so much for watching. And if you're excited to see the Isofarian Guard or anything else, then I need you to meet me at the table.